Hello, Reading Fightin' Phils fans, and welcome back to Mirabito Stadium here in Binghamton, New York, as your Fightin' Phils take on the Binghamton Rumble Ponies for the third straight night, looking for their third straight win. They won the first game 7-6. That was in Max Scherzer's start. Last night, a very definitive 9-3 victory, a season-high 15 hits. Everybody in the starting nine got a hit. McKinley Moore went on to win that game. Noah Skiro had a career high 8 strikeouts. So looking forward to today's action as Colton Eastman takes the mound against Jesus Vargas. We did see Vargas once before this season, and Reading dominated that contest. So looking to do that again. Vito Freixa will be leading off. Holly Castillo, Josh Akami, and Jalen Ortiz in that number 4 hole. Logan Ohapi is getting the night off today. Aldrin Corridor, the designated hitter. Jack Conley in the lineup and catching tonight. And Jonathan Guzman, Chris Sharp, and Kevin Vicuña rounding out those 7-9 batters. For the Binghamton Rumble Ponies, Brandon McElwain will lead it off. Francisco Alvarez back behind the plate tonight with James McCann going back to the New York Mets. Brett Beatty batting third and Ronnie Mauricio the cleanup hitter. That's the Mets 1-3 top prospects. Carlos Cortez and Hayden Singer fifth and sixth respectively. And Jeremy Vasquez, Manny Rodriguez, and Matt Miniker both making their series debut. As both teams head out onto the field, we'll throw it down for the playing of the national anthem and then we'll be back for first pitch of today's contest coming up in just a moment. Fans, stick around. This is definitely going to be a good one. Let's get ready to play some ball here in Binghamton, New York. It is a beautiful evening. It's honestly, it feels kind of like fall here in upstate New York, but I mean, it feels fantastic if you're sitting out in the ballpark. 72 degrees here. Sun will set in about 2 hours. The wind right now, just 8 miles an hour pushing out of the ballpark in left field. I don't think it's going to speed up at all throughout the contest, but I'll let you know as the sun sets. It's overcast right now, so the sun kind of peeking in and out of the clouds. But I don't think it should affect the field of play at all, but we'll let you know if it comes out, if it's shining bright. As Jesus Vargas throwing his warm-up pitches on the mound, Francisco Alvarez back behind the plate for the first time this series. The Mets had their starting catcher, James McCann, rehabbing here. And so he got the catching duties, but now he is gone. And so Alvarez is back behind the plate. Carlos Cortez in left, Brandon McElwain in center, and Matt Winokur making his series debut. over and right field. Brett Beatty in the hot corner. Ronnie Mauricio at short. Manny Rodriguez making his series debut as well at second. And Jeremy Vasquez at first base. Joe Young Kim calling the balls and strikes back behind the plate tonight as Tom Fornarola shifted to third. Fornarola ejected hitting coach Tyler Henson in yesterday's contest. He didn't even leave the dugout, so I don't really know what he could have said. Never got the chance to find out as Matt Carleone is the crew chief and he is over at first base. Vargas, a righty, is 0-4 on the season with a 7.94 ERA. 22 2/3 innings of work here in AA. Now, as I said before, the Phillies have seen him back at home a couple weeks ago. Who played well against him? Well, just about everybody. But Jonathan Guzman and Kevin Vicuña had multi-hit games. And Mickey Moniak was in that contest, obviously not here right now, as Vargas delivers the first pitch. A called strike on the inside corner to Vito Frisia. And that first pitch coming in at 6:38 here in Binghamton, New York. Now the sun's coming right through the clouds. They have turned the lights on for the start of this contest. Guess those clouds are going to come in and out as the sun sets. Frisia takes the ball in the dirt. 1-1 the count here. Fightin's put three up in the first inning last night, looking to do so in this contest. A sharp shooter over to third. Beatty fields it and fires it to first. There is out number one. Brett Beatty had two errors over at third base yesterday. Number two prospect for the Mets is struggling defensively. Here is Ollie Castillo with one away. He had a multi-hit contest. Or just one hit yesterday, multi-hit on Tuesday. Come up with an open stance in the righty batter's box. Vargas, a big delivery, a little chin music to Castillo, bumps him back out of the box. 1-1 the count. The Fightins are 29-36. The Ponies 24-41 as we're in the final week of the first half of the Eastern League season. Castillo punches this into right center field. On the run in is Winokur. It just held up in the sky a little bit too long. And the play is made. There is out number two here in the first. So we wrap up the first half on June 26th. And then we'll reset. Everyone will go back to zero and we'll start anew. That's because a lot of teams will do a lot of roster moves at the halfway point in the season. So teams can look entirely different from the first half. Now, the first half winner and the second half winner of each division are going to play each other. And then each division will have a champion that they send to the final round of the playoffs. That'll battle off for the Eastern League champion of 2022. So that's how the playoffs will work when we get to the end of the season. It's a tight race on either side as Josh Ockamy takes a ball outside. Hartford and Somerset battling on the northeast side, and on the southwest side, it's Richmond and Erie that are fighting for first place. There's a strike to Josh Ockamy with two outs. This is the first lefty batter that Vargas has seen. And Josh takes a pitch upstairs. He had a fun couple of games. Yesterday, three hits, a double, and two singles. He had his first triple of the season on Tuesday. Infield, outfield, back deep. The 2-1 is poked foul. Two balls and two strikes. Still no radar gun here at Mirabito Stadium, so I can't give you any velocities of any kind. I'll do my best to call the pitches. Two balls, two strikes, two outs, top of the first. Vargas comes set on the third base side of the rubber glove, comes over, head down, and that's a called strike three as it curves into the zone. And Ockamy is caught looking. Three up, three down in the first. Redding will send Colton Eastman to the mound in just a moment. Stick around, bottom of the first coming at you. The Seidel Auto Group Deck Picnic appeals to both diehard and casual fans with its summer picnic-like and fun tailgate atmosphere. During your picnic, you may even catch a souvenir as the area is situated directly in prime home run territory behind the left field wall. Regular season tickets are $30 per person for groups of 20 or more, and children 4 and under are free. Visit fightins.com/groups or call 610-370-BALL to reserve your group outing today.
Golden Oaks is an award-winning high-end golf club that offers golfers a country club experience without country club prices. With five sets of tees, golfers of every skill level will enjoy their game. Golden Oaks has Bogey's Pub, a beautiful pro shop, driving range, and learning center that will make any visit complete. Golden Oaks Golf Club is the perfect venue for private events and golf outings. Visit us for our newly opened golf simulators, complete with its own bar area and Bogey's Pub menu items available. You can stay in our beautifully restored 1850s farmhouse and then play our award-winning championship golf course. Each room includes full amenities, cable television, and quaint rustic decor. While on the premises, visit Bogey's Pub for lunch, dinner, or a relaxing beverage. We're ready to serve you here at Golden Oaks and look forward to the 2022 season.
Colton Eastman on the rubber for the Fightin Phils. He's had two starts here for the Reading Fightin Phils after joining us from Lehigh Valley, and he seems like a completely different pitcher. In Lehigh Valley, he had a 4.93 ERA, but here's the thing. He was really settling in the month of June. He had three great starts in Lehigh before coming down to the Fightin Phils, and he's really settled in, a 0.75 ERA in 12 innings of work, so he's gone quality starts both times, as we'll see Brandon McElwain, Francisco Alvarez, and Brett Beatty to start things off, and I'm really excited to watch him throw today, to be honest with you. Weak contact inducing, you'll see a lot of balls on the ground and up in the air today. Just 8 strikeouts under his belt as he gets a swing and a miss from McElwain, 0-2. Righties bat just 200 to him. Lefties 167 here in AA. Spent the majority of the summer with us last year in Reading. And here's the 0-2 to McElwain. Down and away. A ball and two strikes. Jack Conley getting his first start back behind the plate tonight. Vito Frisia stays out in left field. Chris Sharp in center and Jalen Ortiz in right. Ollie Castillo and Jonathan Guzman the left side of the infield. Kevin Vicuña getting the start at second. And Josh Ockamy, of course, at first base. The righty kicks and fires. The 1-2 falls right into the strike zone. And McElwain knows it. He heads right back to the dugout without number one. In the first, the Fightin Phils went down in order to start it off, looking to do the same to the Rumble Ponies and get on the board first. In the top of the second, here is Francisco Alvarez. Now, he had a nice home run on Tuesday. He's the number one prospect for the New York Mets. Didn't do much yesterday, walked twice. But shaking it up a little bit with him back behind the plate, so a little bit more responsibility in today's contest. He's got a very, very wide stance. His left foot is almost at the front of the batter's box, and his right foot is at the back of the batter's box. The 0-1 becomes the 1-1 as Eastman tries to get him to chase down and away. He is a big man. He's only 5'10", but he's 233. He doesn't look 5'10 from where I'm sitting, although to be fair, everybody's taller than me. Eastman takes a big kick, his left leg stretches out towards the plate, and he comes home outside 2-1. Alvarez, 285, pretty good batting average for a catcher, 63 hits. That's team leading, 16 doubles and 16 home runs. He fouls this back, 2-2. Every time he's taken a cut, he's trying to drive that ball over the fence. And a lot of times that'll hit off the wall and he'll be able to take two, and a lot of times it'll go over. About half of his hits are for extra bases. With one out on the board, Eastman brings his glove down to his waist, comes home. 2-2 outside again, 3 balls and 2 strikes. Eastman, always a starter, features fastball, curve, and change. Those are his go-to 3 pitches on his repertoire. And with one out on the board, he gets the sign from Jack Conley behind the plate. Here's the payoff pitch. Ball 4 below the knees, and Francisco Alvarez works a one-out walk. He's going to get down to first base on a free pass. And here is Brett Beatty. Eastman in his fourth season of professional baseball, just 25 years old. Played at Cal State Fullerton. Played in the College World Series, which is pretty cool. Guys were talking about that yesterday with the finals of the College World Series being played. And he was a great starter there. 20-7 record. Hit that big 2-0 in wins as he gets a first pitch strike to the lefty Brett Beatty with a 2.29 ERA. Phillies were able to pick him up after that. Now, righty's bat 200 as the lefty Beatty drives this into right field. Here's the throw from Ortiz. It's quick enough to hold Alvarez at second. And now a little bit of a traffic jam on the base pass here for Eastman. Runners on first and second, one out on the board. Here's Ronnie Mauricio. Mauricio, a tough contest yesterday. He struck out four times against the Fightin Phils. And all four were swinging, and they weren't pretty swings. He was chasing, especially on that final out to end the contest. Tuesday's contest, he went 0 for 5, so still looking for his first hit of the series. Eastman going to work out of a jam here in the first. Has not allowed a run in the first inning with the Fightin Phils as of yet. And his first offering to Ronnie Mauricio is upstairs. 0-0 bottom of the first. There's one out here for the righty. Out of the stretch, he'll go with Alvarez on second and Beatty on first. Chopper, right side, this could be 2-4-6, and they get the double play. Eastman gets a ground out to end the inning, and a huge pitch for the starter here. Scoreless going into two. We'll be right back. The Fightin Phils looking for some offense.
The Reading Fightin Phils are proud to partner with the Berks County Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Program. Together, we are striking out the stigma in order to raise community awareness about mental illness and the prevention of suicide. With three simple words, "Are you okay?" the hope is to begin a conversation to show Berks County that we care. Suicide affects and hurts everyone, but help is here, and we'll work together to help raise awareness about suicide and identify what we can do as a community to prevent it. People in need of assistance and support should call Crisis Intervention at 610-236-0530. That's 610-236-0530.
Berks Immunization Coalition works to provide leadership and education in promoting age-appropriate immunization across the lifespan for all residents of Berks County. This is a coalition comprised of local physicians, nurse practitioners, school nurses, immunization coordinators, immunization advocates, and pharmaceutical representatives working to encourage continuity of immunization through medical resources. They focus on educating both the community and the providers. For more information, please visit www.immunizeba.org. Click Local Coalitions.
Jesus Vargas needed just 10 pitches to get a 1-2-3 first, so the Fightins will send up Ortiz, Corridor, and Jack Conley here to try to put some runners on the base pass and maybe some runs on the board if they can. Vargas getting his final warm-up pitches here at Mirabito Stadium. A little bit of bigger crowd than last night. They reported only 1,013. After having a 7,400 crowd with Max Scherzer in the ballpark. So light night yesterday. And those kind of nights are kind of, honestly, they're kind of awkward because you can hear every word that every fan says. So if somebody is chirping, I mean, it is like the loudest thing. If somebody is cheering, it is like the loudest thing. It's weird. Like when you have, I feel like it's more noticeable than when you have a crowd of like 9,000 at the ballpark than when you have a crowd of a couple hundred. You just hear everything everyone is saying. Ortiz rips this foul above the roof and onto Henry Street down the right field line for strike number one. But a bigger crowd tonight. I know they have a big church group down the third base side. I see a couple of Fightin Phils caps and Phillies jerseys on, so that's always nice. Here's the 0-1 to Ortiz. He holds off. It's above the letters, 1-1. Jalen had a big blast off of Max Scherzer. Had another one in the first inning last night. So back-to-back games with a home run. He had a segment earlier in the season as he drives this the shortstop. Mauricio fires to first, and there's one. But earlier in the summer, he had like a stint where he went 3 or 4 games consecutively with a home run. But he's out in his first at-bat, and here is Aldrin Cordor. Cordor, the DH today. Two-hit contest yesterday. Three-hit contest, excuse me, including a 2-RBI single in the seventh that really just solidified Fightin's lead, and then they just kept going from there. Second time here in Binghamton. I came last summer when the team wrapped up the season here. That was a fun way to end the summer as Cordor skyrockets this upstairs. Down the third baseline, Brett Beatty makes the catch a couple steps into left, and there's out number two. So I have experienced the Mirabito Stadium fields before, but hopefully maybe the pleasant time that everybody had when Max Scherzer was here will draw some fans back to this ballpark because it's, I mean, it's perfect weather to sit outside for a baseball game. So with two away, here is Jack Conley, Reading looking for their first base runner of the game. Jesus Vargas has sat down everybody that he's seen so far tonight as Jack takes a first pitch strike on the outside. He was 1-for-2 against Vargas when they saw him in Reading. Middle infield back deep, corner infielders playing up as Jack drives. This is a shortstop. Everybody pulls the ball here in the second frame. And the left side of the infield gets the job done. The Fightins go up and down in order here. So Eastman back out after a quick break, looking to keep the score 0-0 at Mirabito Stadium.
Hey, psst. Yeah, you. You want to buy some low-priced groceries? Just follow me into this well-lit Lidl grocery store. Here at Lidl, we buy in bulk and cut down on costs wherever possible. Then we pass the savings on to you. Trust me, everything's done totally legit and above board. Nothing to be worried about. Yep, Lidl's pretty great. It's just your run-of-the-mill grocery store, except with way, way, way lower prices. Lidl. Suspiciously low-priced groceries.
The Reading Fightin' Phils, in conjunction with Savage Auto Group Fiesta Fridays, are proud to partner with EXP Realty Associate Broker Alex Patansis throughout the 2022 season. Visit Alex's convenient website at brgpa.com and search for your perfect home today. His custom search bar makes house hunting online easier than ever, and he's there to answer all your questions. Call Alex today at 610-926-8610. EXP Realty Associate Broker Alex Patansis is a proud partner of the Reading Fightin' Phils and all 11 Savage Auto Group Fiesta Friday games during the 2022 season. EXP Realty Group and Alex Patansis, where every move matters. Highline Merchandising, formerly Textiles, is your local small business company that provides screen printing, design, and merchandising services for local, national, and international businesses, bands, shows, and festivals, including 7-time Emmy Award-winning show Schitt's Creek and Unsolved Mysteries. Visit our website at HighlineMerchandising.com.
Bottom of the second inning here. Colton Eastman comes out with 14 pitches. He used a huge double play to get out of the first, so we'll see what he brings as Carlos Cortez, Hayden Sanger, and Jeremy Vasquez are due up in this frame. Righty will see the lefty Cortez first. Lefty's bat just 167 against Eastman here in double A. The sun's still poking through the clouds as the first pitch comes below the knees today. The Phillies made a transaction on our roster. James MacArthur hitting the injured list retroactive to yesterday. I don't have any news on the starter, but hopefully he is well and able to get through whatever it is quickly. And better news, Simone Muziotti began his rehab stint in the FCL, so looking forward to having him back here eventually, as soon as he can get back. He struggled with injuries this year as Cortez fouls it back. The 1-1 outside 2-1. So we'll let you know about his progression. I know a couple other guys working their way through rehabs. Jojo Romero was in Clearwater the last time he pitched on Tuesday. And Ken Emanuel still with Lehigh Valley, I believe. Three balls and one strike, righty on lefty matchup. Eastman misses below, and he'll start off the Binghamton Rumble Ponies with a walk. Here's Hayden Sanger, the designated hitter. It's the first time that we will see the righty up in this series, listed as a catcher, but with the fact that they had Alvarez and McCann, he just kind of got pushed around. Jose Colina also on their roster in the catcher's position, but he's on the developmental list, so technically not active. Sanger now the number two catcher with McCann gone. Drafted in the 24th round, 2018, chops this to the third base side. It is foul. And although Cortez was going, he's going to have to come back with an 0-1 count. Sanger spent some time in AA last year, so second season here with Binghamton. That's the good thing about having the DH spot this season here in the National League, is it just gives some more guys the opportunity to play. He wouldn't be in this game right now or getting as many at-bats without this position, and neither would some of the guys on the Fightin Phils. Sanger bumps this foul down 0-2 here. Eastman looking for out number one in the second frame. Cortez walked down to first, and Josh Ockamy's holding him on over there. Out of the stretch here, the righty kicks and fires the 0-2, and Sanger chases for strike number three on an off-speed pitch. And he picks up out number one, strikeout number two here in the second. And here's Jeremy Vasquez. Another lefty here, a very lefty-heavy Binghamton lineup with a runner on first and one out. This is sent foul down the first baseline. Eastman had a big double play in the first inning. Could he get another one in the second inning? There's strike one to Vasquez. A great this day in history in baseball town. The R. Phils drew up a triple play. Gregory Infante allowed a bunt pop to fall in front of him and then threw to Harold Martinez at third to start a 1-5-6-4. So pitcher, third, short, second, triple play. The first one for Reading since 2005 and the first one at First Energy Stadium since July 3rd, 1997. This is grounded to the right side. It gets in the hole. Ockamy came over for it, but he just couldn't snag it. Ortiz throws it in. But all the way to third goes Carlos Cortez, and that single puts runners on the corners here with just one out for Manny Rodriguez. But a triple play. Man, I've never seen one of those live. I would love to see one of those in person. That is super cool. I was just actually reading about a Philly that had a triple play, Eric Bruntlett. I don't know if anybody remembers that. We went to Cooperstown this morning. Some of the guys went on the bus. Sean organizes a trip every time we're up here. Sean is Philly's Fightin Phils manager here. Runners on the corners, one out. Manny Rodriguez's first at-bat of the series, a called strike. So we went to Cooperstown this morning. I have a bunch to say about that. But they have a whole little thing on Eric Bruntlett with that triple play. His was an unassisted triple play, which is probably why it's in Cooperstown. I think there's only been like six of those in the history of baseball, as the 0-1 is outside, 1-1. And he was one of them. So that is pretty awesome. An unassisted triple play. You just feel that line drive, and then he caught the runner at second off the bag, and the runner at first was going, and he was able to make the tag. Here's one out in the bottom of the second, scoreless at Mirabito Stadium. Rodriguez takes a called strike on the outside. A ball and two strikes here. Manny Rodriguez takes a pitch outside, 2-2. But it was a great trip to Cooperstown. It's only about an hour and a half here from Binghamton, and Eric, our great bus driver from Klein Transportation, drove coaching staff, myself, and a handful of the players up as this pitch is cut on and missed by Manny Rodriguez. Eastman goes way down and away, and he just swings wildly to chase. And there is out number two, a big strikeout pickup here for Colton Eastman. Now a sacrifice fly won't do a thing, as he sees the number nine hitter, Matt Winokur, with runners on the corners. That's Cortez at third and Vasquez at first. Yesterday, it was the bottom of the lineup that produced all the action for Binghamton. Now, they only had a total of 3 runs on 7 hits, but it was really the bottom of the lineup and not those 1-2-3 prospects that was doing the damage. And again, here at the bottom of the lineup is threatening in the bottom of the second. Eastman misses upstairs, pitch number 31. For the starter. 2 outs, trying to get out of this frame here scoreless. Comes home, a perfect pitch on the outside corner, and there's a strike framed by Jack Conley. Sitting was led off by a walk, and Carlos Cortez Vasquez singled to put runners on the corners. In the meantime, Colton Eastman picked up 2 strikeouts. Looks down, then up, glove at the chest, kicks and fires the 1-1 inside. 2 balls and a strike. Seen a couple cool things here with the Fightin' Phils, though. Kyle Doey had an immaculate inning last year. That's when you have 3 straight strikes to 3 straight batters, no other pitches. So 9 total pitches that are strikes. Here's the 2-1. In for a called strike, and Winokur a little frustrated at himself that he took that. Also saw Archimedes Gamboa hit an inside the park home run last year, and not like a Little League home run, like an actual one inside the park. He just had that much speed on him. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs, 2 runners on here. Bottom of the second. This is punched over to Castillo. He'll go over to first, and that'll do it. Another ground ball by Colton Eastman gets them out of the inning clean. And we keep it knotted up at 0 apiece. On to the top of the third. The Fightins go looking for some offense.
When the Reading Fightin' Phils get hungry, we turn to our team feed partners. Special thanks to Wild Missing Family Restaurant and Bakery, Squawk Cafe, Collegeville Italian Bakery Pizzeria, Jimmy G's Railroad House, Mimo's Italian Restaurant and Pizzeria, Jersey Mike's Subs, Klinger's on Crisonia, and Subway for making sure the Fightin' Phils front office is never hungry on game day. Our staff enjoys delicious meals from our team feed partners, but don't take our word for it. Find out for yourself today.
The Reading Fightin' Phils birthday party package is the best way to celebrate a birthday. Whether you are a youngster or an adult, there is no better birthday than a Fightin's birthday. The Fightin's Fan Birthday Package is customizable for fans of any age and starts at just $120. Base packages include 10 general admission tickets to a Fightin's home game, an autographed baseball, and a VIP reserved parking spot. Fans can also add a wide variety of experiences and options to make sure your favorite Fightin's Fan's birthday is a grand slam.
To enjoy a perfectly crafted 1893 from the makers of Pepsi Cola, you must first appreciate its carefully selected ingredients. A dash of cola nut extract, a hint of real sugar, a splash of sparkling water, and a generous amount of attractive spokesperson. Trust me, I'm gorgeous. Cheers to 1893 boldly blended colas, a delicious balancing act of premium ingredients from the makers of Pepsi Cola.
On to the top of the third, Colton Eastman has held the Binghamton Rumble Pony scoreless, but Jesus Vargas has as well. Jonathan Guzman, Chris Sharp, and Kevin Vicuña are due up in this frame. 6 out of 6 batters Vargas has retired here, so Redding looking to get somebody on base here in this half, maybe somebody on the board. As Guzman, who had 2 hits on him the last time since the first pitch he sees sky high. Luckily, it rolls foul for strike number 1. Guzzi's had a pretty good series. first home run since April 10th on Tuesday night. Yesterday, a double and a triple, a walk, as he takes one outside. A ball and a strike. Vargas. A big windup way in. And it's 2-1. Righty's bat 349 against him. Lefty's just a little bit better, 352. Fightin's got just two lefties in the lineup. As Guzzi rolls this up the middle, ranging over Mauricio, and he fires it to first to step in front of Jonathan. And there is out number one. On the bench today for the Fightin' Phils, if needed, Wendell Riho, Logan Ohapi, and Sal Gazzo. For the Rumble Ponies, it is Wyatt Young and Zach Ashford who are available. Here's Chris Sharp. Chops it up the middle, flips his bat, it's going to get through. Rounds first, thinks about second, he's going to hold up. I think he was a little frustrated coming out of the box. But it just skirted by Mauricio at short. And Redding has their first hit of the night here. And Chris Sharp down at first. Kevin Vicuña, who had the night off yesterday, will dig his hole with his right foot and deep in the batter's box and settle in. Binghamton just two hits in the contest, so a lighter start than last night. Runner going, Sharp is way off. And it was a great, great leap. But Vicuña fouls it back, the hit and run. Doesn't quite work out. But Sharp has quite a bit of speed to him. Stole his first base on Tuesday against James McCann. So how about that, your first stolen base of the season against a major league catcher, whose nickname is McCannon. That's pretty crazy. Here's the 0-1. Sharp's going to stay put as the ball comes in above the letters. He gets some information from first base coach Mike Jones. Of course, manager Sean Williams is down the third baseline. Out of the stretch here for the first time today is Jesus Vargas. Vicuña, a slow roller up the first baseline. He's going to play it fair and step off the bag. I think if that kept rolling, it would have gone foul, but played well by Vasquez as he came up for it. It did move Sharp into scoring position here. And there's two outs on the board. That's five ground ball outs that Jesus Vargas has induced right now. But we go back to the top of the order here with Vito Frisia. Frisia will have a runner on second here with two outs. Doubles have been right up his alley as of late. One of those would be perfect to send home the speedy Sharp. We'll see if he takes third. He's going to hold up as Vito takes a called strike on the inside. He grounded to third his first time up. That's Joe Young Kim back behind the plate calling the balls and strikes. Umpires rotate clockwise. Everybody gets two times back behind the dish. A looping curve falls in for strike number two. With the righty up, Manny Rodriguez out at second, keeping a close eye on Sharp. He's about 5 feet off the bag. Two outs on the board. Vargas looks back. Here's the 0-2. And it's inside. It gets past the catcher. And Chris Sharp is going to take third. That was a very weird offering by Vargas. He almost threw it while still looking back at Sharp, and he was honestly a little bit off balance. But either way, Chris is now 90 feet from home. Redding trying to put the first run on the board here. Vito Frisia with a ball and two strikes, two outs on the board. Infield, outfield, back deep. Vargas kicks and fires, and that's below the knees. 2-2. Vito, very patient hitter at the plate. We'll look to drive in Chris Sharp over at third. Here's the 2-2. He takes it up into right center, and it's going to drop in and score a run. Vito Frisia with an RBI single plates Chris Sharp, and the Fightins lead 1-0. And, man, have they been very good at hitting with runners in scoring position in this series. Here's Ollie Castillo with a runner on first and one away. Frisia shuffles off the bag. Two away, excuse me. Open stance by Ollie at a deep fly ball to center. His first time up. Castillo's bat splits as the ball rolls foul. You can see that shard of it flying off down the third baseline. They're going to have to get him a freshie here. Man, that just splintered right through. Wow. So we'll get a different bat. This one is dark brown. The other one was light brown. Open stance, he steps back in. A 1-1 count. Vargas stealing slow with runners on. Comes down and away. 2-1. Castillo takes this up in a right center. McElwain on the run. It hangs up in the sky just enough for him to come over and make the catch, and that'll do it. But Vito Frisia drives in the first run of the game. Chris Sharp crosses the plate, and Reading leads 1-0 onto the bottom of the third. Colton Eastman in just a moment.
Roof Max of West Reading is a safe, easy, proven, and affordable alternative to a complicated and expensive asphalt roof replacement. Roof Max's revolutionary new technology uses natural, plant-based bio-oil to restore shingles' flexibility and instantly add 5 years of life to a roof. And treatment is around 20% of the cost of a complete roof replacement. From homes to commercial complexes, RoofMax of West Reading can help. Visit GetRoofMax.com or call 610-717-3949 for more information.
ROG Orthodontics is the proud official partner of the ROG Orthodontics Fightin' Phil's Kids Club. Join today at fightins.com to get your free ROG Orthodontics Kids Club t-shirt and visit fantasticsmiles.com for more information on why ROG Orthodontics is voted number one in Berks and Monco. ROG Orthodontics and the Fightin' Phil's, two great hometown partners.
Cornwall Manor is an active senior living community on the 190-acre wooded campus in Cornwall, Lebanon County. The community offers independence and opportunities for wellness and fitness, as well as educational and musical programs, and the peace of mind of having convenient health care on site. Cornwall Manor offers a range of residential choices from apartments to homes. Prospective residents are welcome to visit us for lunch and have a chance to learn more about the community. More information is available online at cornwallmanor.org. Cornwall Manor, celebrating over 70 years of senior living.
Reading gets the first run on the board here. Vito Frisia drives in Chris Sharp, and they lead 1-0. When Reading scores first, they are 12-7 on the road, so looking to keep that rolling here. The Fightin' Phils in their navy blue tops and the road gray pants, the alternate logo cap on the front. It's navy, red, and that white cursive R. They wore these on Tuesday for the first time this season, and they won in them. So, of course, they wanted to wear them yesterday, but they had to wear the road grays considering Binghamton was in a navy top, and that wouldn't have worked out very well. Colton Eastman's end to first pitch ball. We'll see the top of the order in Brandon McElwain. Crushes this ball deep to left, but it rolls foul into the picnic area, and that's just a very long strike. Reading usually wear these jerseys for BP, but when we hit a certain point in the season, most teams are able to switch to BP matching tops and shorts. And manager Sean Williams allowed that them to start doing that last week. It just gets so hot out there, and you're standing out there for about 2 hours in the sun. And so you just make sure everybody looks uniform, though. They have the same shirt and the same pants. The reason that they initially wear jerseys as the 1-1 from Eastman coming in is because they have to have their numbers on them somewhere so scouts can see who they are. So they have the T-shirt tops that have numbers on them as well. They're bright red and then navy pants. Here's the 2-1 in from McElwain. Takes it sky high. Josh Ockamy a couple steps back. Right beyond first base, he makes the catch, and there is out number one. I think everybody's happy to wear the shorts now. I mean, it has gotten warm out there, especially in the direct sunlight. But I know the BP shorts, they don't have any pockets in them. And that's a little frustrating because the guys want to take seeds out there with them and stuff. I'm like, welcome to being a woman here, if anyone's listening. Women's pants never have pockets. It's very frustrating. First pitch to Francisco Alvarez, a swinging strike. He walked in his last at-bat. Rumble Ponies in their home whites today. A navy cap with the Rumble Pony on the front. Rumble Pony, you might ask, what is that? It's one of those horses on the carousel. This is the carousel capital of the world as Alvarez takes a ball, 1-1 the count. So that's what it is. It's a carousel horse. Not quite menacing. As Eastman misses in the dirt, 2-1. Try to keep track of how well we play in each different jersey. I know it seems like an unimportant stat, but to some superstitious players, it's very important as Eastman sends the 2-1 to Alvarez outside 3-1. Honestly, they played the best in the Luchadores. 10 wins as the Luchadores. They're 5-0 in specialty jerseys. Specialty jerseys like the Cancer Knight, the Harry Potter Knight, military appreciation as Alvarez takes ball 4 downstairs. And for the second time today, he walks down to first. So Binghamton now has the tying run on first base. Reading leads 1-0 here in the bottom of the third. There's only one out as Brett Beatty comes up. Beatty singled his first time up. Phillies don't play till 9:40 tonight. They're on the West Coast against the San Diego Padres, looking to turn it around for a win. Beatty from the left side here. Eastman takes him inside, a called strike. Conley puts a good glove on it. Keeps it in the zone. Lehigh Valley home at Coca-Cola Park, though, playing Norfolk. They trail by one, but they're threatening in the bottom of the first. Derek Hall's up at the plate with two on and nobody out. In our game, runner on first, Brett Beatty up at the plate with a 1-1 count here. Off-speed pitches keep breaking too far outside for both right and left batters. Hear from Eastman, and sometimes they do chase, and other times the batters hold up as the 1-1 is grounded on the right side in the hole. Nobody can get to it. Ortiz rips it in as Alvarez has to stop at second. 2-1 and just one out, and Eastman is fighting through every frame here, but he has not allowed a run on the board as of yet. Has thrown 46 pitches so far. Two starts here in Reading, 85 and 91. So he should go as deep as that will allow him to in this contest. Here's Ronnie Mauricio, who grounded out into a double play his first time up. Eastman would love another one of those. Another batter from the left side. Hits the outside corner, strike one. Two on, one out. Bottom of the third, your Fightin' Phils lead 1-0. Both teams have two hits on the board. Eastman looks back at Alvarez on second. Now he comes home, ground ball right side. A diving Vicuña pops up, and they're just going to get the one out at second. Runners on the corners here. Mauricio safe at first on a fielder's choice. Vicuña impressive enough to get even one out there as he's a dive for that. Made sure to set his feet before throwing. Didn't want to throw it away. And they get the runner at second. Alvarez shifts to third. And Mauricio, of course, at first here for Carlos Cortez. But now there's two outs on the board. First pitch is in for a strike. Jersey Shore just in the bottom of the second against Brooklyn. DJ Stewart drove in a run. And they lead 1-0. Clearwater also leads 1-0. Marcus Lee Sang across the plate. A lot of 1-0 scores so far early in the contest. Eastman hits the outside part for the second straight time here. Trying to get out of the bottom of the third clean. Keep the Fightin' Phils on top. 1-0 here early on. Vito Frisia drove in Chris Sharp in the top half of this frame. Very close to the plate. On the left side is Carlos Cortez. Eastman comes inside this time. He holds up 1-2. Hasn't moved the bat off his shoulder yet, Carlos Cortez. He walked back in a second. This is up the middle and it gets through. This game is going to be tied at 1-1 as Alvarez jogs home. Cortez drives in Binghamton's first run of the contest here, and the inning continues with two on and two out here for Hayden Sanger. Eastman going to go after Singer for the second time today. He struck out swinging his first time up. Two teams have played each other 8 times this season. Both teams have won 4 games apiece, so sort of a rubber match here. 2 balls and no strikes to Hayden Sanger. Mauricio, a good runner out there on second. Carlos Cortez over at first. 2 outs here, bottom of the third, and we're all tied up at 1-1. Eastman looks back at second. Now he comes home. This is chopped slowly to third. Charging Castillo, the throw on the run, and it's good. Gets Sanger out at first. Binghamton strands 2 runners on, but they do plate a run. It is 1-1 here. Top of the 4th at Mirabito Stadium. Here we come.
Cornwall Manor is an active senior living community on the 190-acre wooded campus in Cornwall, Lebanon County. The community offers independence and opportunities for wellness and fitness, as well as educational and musical programs, and the peace of mind of having convenient health care on site. Cornwall Manor offers a range of residential choices from apartments to homes. Prospective residents are welcome to visit us for lunch and have a chance to learn more about the community. More information is available online at cornwallmanor.org. Cornwall Manor, celebrating over 70 years of senior living.
The time has come for businesses to grow, to prosper, to innovate, to succeed. Tompkins Vist Bank continues to be a leading lender to companies in southeastern Pennsylvania. We make decisions locally and invest locally so local businesses can thrive. Call a business advisor today and see how we can help your business grow. Tompkins Vist Bank, locally focused, a world of possibilities. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Here, and we're kind of back where we started, tied at 1-1. Both teams scoring 1 run in the third. Vito Frisia driving home Chris Sharp. And Carlos Cortez bringing home Francisco Alvarez. But it's a Fightin's turn up here as Jesus Vargas comes out. He'll see Josh Acme, Jalen Ortiz, and Aldrum Corridor here. 33 pitches for the righty starter. Acme struck out looking his first time up. We'll step in on the left side. Vargas hits the outside corner to start him off with a strike. Last outing, he made it just 3 innings of work, 9 hits, 6 runs against the Bowie Bay Sox. So already a much better start here for Vargas. Longest outing so far has been 5 1/3 this season. Here's the 1-1 to Josh. Fouls it back behind home plate. This is Vargas' first season in the Mets organization. Spent last year with the Los Angeles Dodgers, splitting his time as a starter and a reliever, but the Mets really want to keep him as a starter. Picked him up as a free agent after last year. Spent 7 years with the Dodgers, so I'm sure it's pretty tough to change organizations like that, especially, I mean, huge difference. You're switching coasts as well. Born and raised in Venezuela as Josh takes a pitch outside. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Redding trying to start this off with a base runner, and Acme stays alive, fouling it back. Anybody that comes up to the plate now is representing the go-ahead run here. Each team has 1 apiece. Checks his swing and he does go around, punched out for the second time today by Joe Young Kim. And here is Jalen Ortiz with 1 away. Ortiz grounded out sharply to the shortstop his first time up. He's had home runs in both of the games this series, so looking to continue that streak here. Try to put the Fightin' Phils on top. As the righty comes home, Ortiz, kind of a wild swing for strike number 1. That was pitch number 40 here too for Jesus Vargas. Ortiz looks to check his swing, but he fouls it up the first base side, and that is good enough for strike number 2. Infield, outfield, back deep. Those guys in center and in left are playing just a couple steps from the warning track. Here's the 0-2. Jalen strikes out swinging, and back-to-back K's for the Fightin' Phils. Puts 2 outs on the board here in the 4th for Aldrum Corridor. Redding's had just 2 hits in the contest, Chris Sharp and Vito Frisia, but they were able to do it with runners in scoring position. They made good use of those 2 hits and drove in a run. Tied at 1 apiece here, top of the 4th. 2 outs as Corridor takes a first pitch strike from the left side. Way inside comes Vargas, 1-1 now. There's 1 below the knees. Corridor takes 2 balls and 1 strike, 2 outs here. Top of the 4th inning. Beautiful night here at the ballpark. Clouds are now covering the sun. Everything's in the shade. This Corridor pokes it the opposite way, slowly rolling it to Brett Beatty right in the shift. And a ground out sets the Fightin' Phils down in order here in the 4th. Colton Eastman up very quickly back with a tie ball game, 1-1. Bottom of the 4th in just a moment.
White Star Tours and Travel Centers offers the R. Phils fan road trip again this season. It's your chance to hit the road with other R. Phils fans, see an R. Phils road game, meet with an R. Phils player, and see 2 Philadelphia Phillies road games. The White Star R. Phil's fan road trip visits Erie and Pittsburgh, Thursday, July 28th through Sunday, July 31st. You see the R. Phil's at Erie, meet with an R. Phil's player or coach, then head to Pittsburgh for a tour of the city, including the incline, and a ride on the Yankee Clipper riverboat. You will attend two Phillies games versus the Pirates on Friday and Saturday before traveling home Sunday with a stop at the Flight 93 National Memorial. Visit the customer service booth for more info on the White Star R. Phil's fan road trip to Erie and Pittsburgh. Space is very limited. Sign up today.
Nursing home neglect is a serious problem. If you or a loved one has suffered from bed sores obtained in a nursing home or a fall down in a nursing home resulting in a fracture, our friends at Swartz Culliton can help. Call the attorneys at Swartz Culliton for a free consultation. Their phone number is 1-800-JUSTICE. That's 1-800-587-8423. Once again, call 1-800-JUSTICE today. Swartz Culliton is a proud sponsor of the Reading Fightin' Phils.
Colton Eastman taking on the bottom of the fourth inning, looking for his first clean frame. He'll see Vasquez, Rodriguez, and Winokur tied up at one apiece. The Fightin' Phils went down in order in the top half. Eastman looking to make quick work and put his team back up to bat here as the lefty Vasquez comes up. There's a first pitch ball. Eastman, glove at his chest. Now he moves it down to his waist as he turns his body and comes home inside. Two balls and one strike. Five lefties in the lineup here. More than half for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies as Eastman hits the strike zone 2-1 now. Line drive into left, racing in is Vito Frisia, and he makes the grab overhead. A little bit too much heat on it, and there is out number one for the Rumble Ponies as Manny Rodriguez, not a lefty, comes up. Game number 66. Of 138 here at Mirabito Stadium, 48% of the way done this season. I can't believe it. We're almost at the halfway point. Pretty sad about it. This is taken out to deep center field. Chris Sharp at the warning track. Jumps up, bounces into the wall, and makes the catch. It was well struck, but it kind of comes to a point out there in center field, and that's exactly where Chris Sharp caught it, in the deepest part of the ballpark. They don't even have how deep it is down to center field. I guess I could pop that into Google. I feel like it should be labeled out in the ballpark, but it is 330 down the right and left field lines. See what if I can find the dimensions on the internet somewhere. Dead to center, 400 feet, says Wikipedia, so take that as you will. With two quick outs, here's the number nine hitter, Matt Winokur. And he sends this out to center field. Sharp should be playable. This time in front of the warning track, he makes the catch, and there it is, spoken into existence. A three up, three down inning for Colton Eastman puts us into the fifth, still tied at one, but it's the Fightin' Phils turn to bat.
Nursing home neglect is a serious problem. If you or a loved one has suffered from bed sores obtained in a nursing home or a fall down in a nursing home resulting in a fracture, our friends at Swartz Culliton can help. Call the attorneys at Swartz Culliton for a free consultation. Their phone number is 1-800-JUSTICE. That's 1-800-587-8423. Once again, call 1-800-JUSTICE today. Swartz Culliton is a proud sponsor of the Reading Fightin' Phils. The Reading Fightin' Phils are proud to partner with Humane Pennsylvania throughout the 2022 season. Humane Pennsylvania is the region's premier leader in animal welfare and empowers the people in our communities to increase their capacity to care for animals so that all animals are healthy, safe, and treated humanely. Humane Pennsylvania is proud to be a Fiesta Friday and Bark in the Park sponsor. Learn more about Humane Pennsylvania and how you can help build the best community for animals anywhere by visiting humanepa.org.
This is the Crazy Hot Dog Vendor coming to you from the radio booth. When I need to get somewhere in a hurry, and the ostrich isn't cutting it, I hop on my Harley Davidson from Classic Harley Davidson. It's your one-stop shop for all your Harley needs. They have everything you need from boots, jackets, t-shirts, gloves, mugs, and oh yeah, they have a great selection of bikes too, which are almost as good on gas as an ostrich. Go to Classic Harley Davidson for everything Harley Davidson, and I'll see you at Harley Night.
Quick fourth on either side. Both teams went down 1-2-3 as the Fightin' Phils will send up Jack Conley, Jonathan Guzman, and Chris Sharp here, trying to put some offense on the board. Jesus Vargas still out to work here. Vargas, 46 pitches. He's got 6 ground outs so far today, 3 strikeouts and 2 flyouts. He's allowed just 2 hits and no free passes down to first. Working through the Fightins second time through. Righty-righty matchup. Vargas deals to Jack Conley, and it's a first pitch ball down and away. Jack takes this way out to center field. On the run back is McElwain, and he makes the catch to send Jack back to the dugout without number one. That was well struck. I don't know if you can hear the crack off the bat in the crowd mic, but that was a fantastic sound and good piece of contact by Jack Conley, but it results in out number one. And here is Jonathan Guzman. Guzzi grounded out to short his first time up, takes a first pitch outside, holds up his swing. 1-0. The train is going behind the left field right now. It's a long, long train. It's many cars. I should have started a stopwatch when it started going by. There's the end of it right now, but it is not a person train as this is grounded to third. Beatty bobbles it, and he's able to get it over to first in time, a heartbeat in front of Jonathan Guzman. He is having trouble at third, to be honest. But way to recover on that play, I guess. He can send it over to first for out number two. Now I can't think of the opposite of a commuter train. Like a freight train, I guess? I feel like there's another word I can't think of. Anyways, it's already gone, but it's got to be at least 5 minutes of train as Chris Sharp takes a first pitch strike. 2 quick outs here in the fifth. Sharp had a single and a run scored. The only one for the Fightins back in the third as he takes a first pitch strike and then a ball outside. Reading just 2 hits, Binghamton just 3, as we're tied up at 1 apiece, top of the fifth. Both starters still in the contest. Vargas deals a 1-1 outside. Sharp lays off. In the on-deck circle, Kevin Vicuña before we go back to the top of the order. Sharp. A little bit behind a breaking ball, and the count evens 2-2. Seating bowl from about past first to past third. Sharp takes a called strike, 3 at the knees. Alvarez already back into the dugout, and a quick 1-2-3 again for the Fightin' Phils here in the fifth. Eastman back out quickly, looking to keep this ball game tied up at 1 apiece.
The award-winning Reading Hospital Tower Health Character Pool Party provides an unforgettable night out with your family and friends. Enjoy a baseball game while swimming in the 87-degree heated pool directly behind the right field home run wall. Plus, 2.5 hours of all-you-can-eat buffet and photos and autographs with the crazy hot dog vendor and the Fightin Phil's mascot band. Regular season tickets are $31 per person for groups of 20 or more. Give us a call today at 610-370-BALL.
For top flight local jobs, go with who you know. J.P. Mascaro & Sons, a leading waste removal company. To meet today's employment and service demands brought on by the pandemic, Mascaro is upgrading its already highly competitive employee wage and benefit package for drivers, collection crew helpers, and other positions. Call 888-MASCARO, M-A-S-C-A-R-O, for details. Work for an established local family business committed to its employees. Again, call 888-MASCARO today or apply online at www.jpmascaro.com. Highline Merchandising, formerly Textiles, is your local small business company that provides screen printing, design, and merchandising services for local, national, and international businesses, bands, shows, and festivals, including 7-time Emmy Award-winning show Schitt's Creek and Unsolved Mysteries. Visit our website at highlinemerchandising.com.
Fightins went down in order in the top of the fifth. Colton Eastman looking to do the same. He'll have the top of the order, Brandon McElwain, Francisco Alvarez, and Brett Beatty to do so here. We're all tied up at one apiece. And Eastman is ready to go, just waiting for McElwain to get in. He's 0 for 2 today, 63 pitches for the starter. Sends a first pitch outside to McElwain. Man, it smells like cheeseburgers and beer. There's a big sweet next to me, and they're cooking them up over there. I'm on the top level here as McElwain takes a pitch below the knee, so everything in the stadium is below me here. Only two levels, so it's not like I'm up dramatically high. Seating bowl, then there's party decks down the right and left field line. Nothing in the outfield. Video boards in right center and in left as Eastman misses on three straight pitches here to McElwain. Batter's eye dead to center. Otherwise, there's just kind of ads trolling around the outfield. Here's the 3-0. Inside corner, he misses, and that is ball number four. And now there's a little chirping from the dugout on the Fightin side. Yesterday, hitting coach Tyler Henson got a little angry about the calls on the outside corner, picking and choosing when they want that to be a strike and a ball. That was Tom Fornarola. Today's Joe Young Kim back behind the plate. So a walk to McElwain will start off the frame. And here is Francisco Alvarez, who chases the first pitch. Vicuña deep in the hole at second, fires to first, and he gets him. I don't know how he did that. Dang. So he's all the way to the right side of the bag. The ball was on the left side. Was able to get it. He couldn't get the leading runner, McElwain, because he was there quickly, but he did get the out at first. Guzzi was playing deep back at short, so he wasn't able to get over in time, but well done by Kevin Vicuña to get one out. McElwain on second here. That's the go-ahead run as Brett Beatty steps up. He's 2 for 2 today from the left side. Beatty takes the ball outside. Big shift here on Beatty. Takes this up and deep to right. Sharp going back at the wall, and this is well out of the ballpark. A 2-run home run for Brett Beatty, the Mets' number 2 prospect, makes it 3-1 Binghamton. A 3-hit contest for Beatty. And Binghamton has the lead right now with one out in the fifth. That's his 7th of the season. That ball just kept carrying. And here is Ronnie Mauricio now. Base paths are cleared here for Eastman. Mauricio 0 for 2 today. First pitch ball to Mauricio. Eastman comes home outside. Lead off, walk, and then it's home run by Brett Beatty. Put the Rumble Ponies up 3-1 here. Mauricio sends the grounder down the first base side. Ockamy gives chase, but no need. It's foul. From the left side here, Eastman ready to go. This is below the knees, 3-1. Fightin Phil's bullpen is out beyond the left field while they're up on a hill. I can see all the guys sitting in a chair, folding chairs up there. Binghamton's bullpen's in right center as this is grounded in the hole on the right side. Acuna laid out for it. Here's the throw by Ortiz, the play at second, the tag by Guzzi. They say he didn't get him. Tries to put the tag on him again. And they say that Mauricio is safe at second. I need a replay of that. Great throw there by Jalen Ortiz, though, and right. Our Phils have had 19 outfield assists this season, and with the runner on second, here is Carlos Cortez, and we are going to see a mound visit here from Jack Conley. Does not look like Matt Hockenberry is going to come out right now. Acuna is getting a lot of work in on the right side. Carlos Cortez has been on twice today, a walk and a single here. The Rumble Ponies lead 3-1 in the bottom of the fifth, and they're still threatening here with a runner on second. Jack's going to come back behind the plate now. Cortez. Third lefty in a row here. Eastman looks back at second. Now we'll come home. This is a sky-high pop-up. Guzzi gives chase in shallow left. He's going to make the catch. And there is out number two. Mauricio forced to stay on second. And Hayden Singer is coming up to bat on the right side. He's 0 for 2. Eastman and battled in this contest. Only 3 runs on 6 hits here. Fightin's 1 run on 2 hits. Trying to get out of the bottom of the fifth inning. Mauricio on second. He certainly got some speed to him. And this is sent foul into the stands. Foul ball back on the roof is strike number 1 here to Hayden Singer. 2 outs and a runner on second. Binghamton leads by 2 runs. Eastman goes down and away. The count evens. When Redding comes back up in the sixth, they'll have Acuna and then back to the top of the order with Freesia and Castillo. Eastman keeps the glove in his glove hand. His throwing hand is hanging down by his thighs. Now he comes set, looks back, fourth, comes home in the dirt. 2-1. Mauricio shuffles off the bag at second, another in the dirt. Jack Conley keeps it in front of him. And now the count is 3-1. Doesn't look like there's anybody up in the R. Phils bullpen. They could be back behind the wall, and maybe I just don't see it. Yeah. Chopper to third. Castillo is like a vacuum over there. He's trying to put the tag on Mauricio. He throws it to Vicuña, and they get him off the bag. What a play by Ali to get the job done. But Binghamton scores two on a two-run shot by Brett Beatty. They lead 3-1. The R Phils are up, need some offense here in just a moment.
There you are in the great wide open when you hear it. Dinner time. When you're hungry, you're not going to let 5,000 feet of mountain get in your way. And if they try, that's what Kia's lineup of exceptionally capable SUVs with available all-wheel drive is for. The Telluride, Sorento, Sportage, and Seltos are how you know we take this pretty seriously. The SUVs and the dinner. Hurry into your local Kia dealer today. Kia, movement that inspires.
Visit Kia.com for details. Always drive safely.
Feesers Incorporated, a family-owned, full-line food service distributor located in central Pennsylvania, services restaurants, sporting facilities, theme amusement parks, healthcare facilities, educational facilities, and other institutions throughout Pennsylvania and the Mid-Atlantic region. For over 100 years, Feesers and its employees have committed themselves to making customer service their highest priority. Feesers works hard to provide customers with the products they require, delivered by their helpful fleet drivers. Feesers is large enough to serve and small enough to care. For more information, call 800-326-2828 or Feesers.com.
The Reading Fightin' Phils are proud to partner with the Berks County Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Program. Together, we are striking out the stigma in order to raise community awareness about mental illness and the prevention of suicide. With three simple words, are you okay? The hope is to begin a conversation to show Berks County that we care. Suicide affects and hurts everyone. But help is here, and we'll work together to help raise awareness about suicide and identify what we can do as a community to prevent it. People in need of assistance and support should call Crisis Intervention at 610-236-0530. That's 610-236.
Our Phils trail by two now. Brett Beatty's home run put the Rumble Ponies up 3-1, but we're only about midway through this game. Certainly lots of baseball left to go. Kevin Vicuña takes this deep to left field. Looking back is Cortez, and Vicuña gets the job done. His first home run of the season cuts the lead of Binghamton down to just one. Takes that first pitch way out to left field. These guys are super pumped for him in the dugout. You love to see it. And here is Vito Frisia. Fightins have done back-to-back shots three times this summer, once in this series. And Frisia's been involved in that before. Let me just pull that up in my game notes here. Give me a second. He did it back with Josh Ockamy on May 1st. He was the first one in that. Logan Ohapi, Madison Stokes, Wendell Rijo, Jonathan Guzman, as he sends this deep down the right field side. It's foul. A long ball, but not quite there. And the count moves to 1-1. So Frisia will come back in. Nobody outs here. We're in the top of the order here. He's 1-for-2. One of the R Phils, just three hits. And there's a pitch inside. Overhead comes Vargas. Hits the outside corner. Man, calling him real close there. Now that evens the count 2-2. Top of the sixth. Sharply struck over to third. Beatty tosses it across the diamond, and there's out number one for Ali Castillo. Ali Castillo, two very hard hit balls into the outfield. I think he's getting ready to send one out, just like Kevin Vicuña, looking for his first of the season as he takes a first pitch strike. One to right, one to center. How about one deep to left? on the ground to Mauricio. Shortstop over to first. And that is 8 groundouts here for Jesus Vargas. And, yep, all of them are on the left side. Redding really pulling the ball tonight to the shortstop and the third baseman. And here is Josh Ockamy, who has struck out looking twice in today's contest. Looking to turn it around here with 2 outs on the board. The R fills down by just 1, so everybody who comes up represents the tying run here for the Fightin' Phils. Kevin Vicuña led off this frame with a solo shot out to left. And Ockamy takes one above the letters. Waiting on deck, Jalen Ortiz. No on-deck circles here in Binghamton. And honestly, I don't think it makes a difference because nobody stands in them anyways. Slow roller down the first baseline, foul, and the count evens 1-1. But they look nice, you know. A little extra advertisement on them. Fightin' Phils, 2 runs on 3 hits. Binghamton, 3 runs on 6 hits. Top of the 6th inning here at Mirabito Stadium as the sun is beginning to set. Vargas versus Ockamy on the left side. Pitch number 68 of the game coming in. The 1-2 way inside. And the count evens 2 balls and 2 strikes. Overhead, Vargas, a big leg kick, and Josh fouls it onto the roof. He'll get to go again. Here's the 2-2 with 2 outs. Another foul ball back here from Josh Ockamy. That was pitch number 6 of the at-bat. Infield, outfield, back deep. 2-2. Josh, foul back. Pitch number 8 coming in. Wind still pushing just slightly out to left field. With 2 outs in the board, Ockamy steps in close to the plate. Alvarez on the outside corner. The 2-2 way out. Probably didn't want it out that far. And Josh holds up, and here is the full count. The payoff pitch checks his swing, and a very aggressive strike 3 call from Joe Young Kim. Are they saying he went, or are they saying it was a strike? That was the wildest call I've ever seen for strike 3, but that will do it. Kevin Vicuña gets a home run. His first of the season makes it 3-2. The Fightin's trail by just 1 now, bottom of the 6th. We'll see Colton Eastman in just a moment. Thank you. Colton Eastman's going to get the sixth with 81 pitches under his belt. He'll see Jeremy Vasquez, and he starts him off with the first pitch fouled back. Manny Rodriguez and Matt Winokur are due up the 7th through 9. The last time he saw just these three guys, he got them down in order. Redding put a run on thanks to a solo shot by Kevin Vicuña. They trail by just one run now. Eastman looking to keep it that way. Here's the 0-1. Good frame by Jack Conley. They don't get the call in the inside corner, and I think Redding's getting a little frustrated. A little bit of a shift here for the lefty, Jeremy Vasquez. Guzzi's almost back behind second. This is taken right to where Chris Sharp is standing. I kid you not, he does not take one step over. Sandlot style, just lifts his glove into the air, and the ball comes right in. There is out number one here for Manny Rodriguez. Rodriguez 0 for 2, a strikeout and a flyout, both to Colton Eastman as he sees a call on the outside corner. Eastman fires in. This is a bullet down into left field, but Freesia is all over it. So wind has completely died down now. He makes the catch. There's two. Matt Winokur, another lefty. He's 0 for 2. As the sun set, it peaks through the clouds a little bit. The outfield is spotted in the sun everywhere else, kind of in the shade. Just coming off the summer solstice, the longest day of the year, I think, setting about 8:30. That doesn't mean it's dark at 8:30, though. Eastman's got two quick outs, looking for the third, as this is grounded foul up the first baseline. That's Mariano Duncan down at first. The manager, Reed Brignac, over in the coach's box at third. Eastman steps back. Here's the 0-1. Line drive up the middle. Playable for Chris Sharp. He makes the catch in a 1-2-3 frame. All balls in the air. Sets down the Rumble Ponies in order. To the seventh we go. Redding trails 3-2.
The Fightin' Phils know who to call for trash and recycling services. A proven winner, J.P. Mascaro & Sons. The industry leader for over 50 years. Trust the familiar Mascaro Blue Elephant to provide dependable, quality service for your home or business. That's J.P. Mascaro & Sons, one of the top companies in its industry. Trash and recycling services for home, business, and industry. We are hiring and have open positions in Berks County. Check our website for open positions at jpmascaro.com or call 1-888-MASCARO. J.P. Mascaro & Sons, ready to serve you.
Burke's Packing is a family-owned and operated meat processor located here in Redding, specializing in hot dogs, ham, specialty meats, and more. Burke's Packing provides America's classic ballpark with quality products, including the highly acclaimed flat-top grilled hot dog. Join us for Burke's Packing Sunday Family Fun Days at Sunday home games all season long at Burke's Energy Stadium.
Lidl is a normal grocery store with aisles and shelves and high-quality groceries, but only Lidl has really low prices. Like so low they're too good to be true. But true. Lidl, suspiciously low priced groceries.
Reading down by just one run here as Colton Eastman set down the side in order to get out of the sixth inning clean. The Fightin' Phils trail 3-2, but they've got the heart of their order. Jalen Ortiz, Aldrum Corridor, and Jack Conley are due up. Jalen 0-2 today, takes a first pitch strike. Reading just three hits, singles from Chris Sharp and Vito Frisia in that solo home run off the bat of Kevin Vicuña. Ortiz takes a ball. Here's the 1-1. Slowly rolls. Foul. Vargas still out on the mound. 76 pitches here. Eastman 87. I can't tell if I see anyone in either bullpen right now. Tough to see beyond the outfield wall as Jalen holds off on a ball 2-2. -69 degrees as the sun peaks behind the clouds, cooling off a little bit here in upstate New York. The ball goes way down and away. This is the third time through the order of here for Jesus Vargas, and having arguably the best start of his season against the Fightin' Phils. Full count here to Jalen Ortiz. The Reading Fightin' Phils looking to start off this frame with the leadoff runner. Payoff pitch is lined into left center. It's going to drop in for a base hit, and that's exactly what Jalen Ortiz does, a leadoff single. He represents the tying run, and now everybody that comes up will represent the go-ahead run, including Aldrum Corridor, who comes up for the third time today, 0-2. There's a first pitch, strike called inside. Corridor, both of his balls have gone the opposite way today, over to third. There's a ball inside. The count evens one apiece. Phillies don't start till 9:40 tonight. They're on the West Coast against the San Diego Padres. Lehigh Valley is leading 6-3 against Norfolk. They're home at Coca-Cola Park, heading into the bottom of the third as Corridor takes one way inside. 2-1. You guessed it, Derek Hall has another RBI to his name. Mickey Moniak, homer. Jorge Bonifacio, sack fly. Edgar Cabral, double. Lots going on there for the Iron Pigs. Michael Plassmeyer on the mound. Here's the 2-1. Hits the outside corner. It was low and outside for a strike two. Jersey Shore trailing Brooklyn 3-1. They're only in the middle of the fifth. And Clearwater leading Tampa 2-1. Wilfredo Flores has all the RBIs. This is on the left side, backhanded by Mauricio, and he throws it away from the second baseman. Corridor is going to take two. And stopping at third is Jalen Ortiz. A lot of defensive miscues in this series for Binghamton. I was impressed that Mauricio got a glove on it, backhanded it, did not set his feet, and just threw it too far away from Rodriguez to make the play. And I'm going to guess that that's not going to get Corridor a hit. We'll have to see how they score it. They haven't updated the board as of yet. But either way, I mean, he ran it out and he took two, which was very impressive. And the Fightins have two in scoring position now here for Jack Conley. Quick meeting at the mound as Alvarez heads out to talk to Vargas. He's up to 84 offerings here. Corridor at second. Ortiz gets his way to third. Good hustle there by Aldrum to get himself in scoring position and out of the double play ball. There's no outs on the board here for Jack Conley, who's 0-2 tonight, and the Fightins are threatening. They're down by just one run here in the top of the seventh. Jack pops this sky high in the infield. Coming back and making the catch is Rodriguez. Nobody can move there. Then there's one out on the board. So they do rule that as a fielder's choice for Corridor. It doesn't get credit for the single. And everybody advances on the throwing error by Mauricio. Here's Jonathan Guzman with a chance to do some damage here for the Fightin' Phils, trying to tie it up. Jalen Ortiz is just 90 feet from home. Infield's going to play in, try to protect the run at the plate. There's two on, both in scoring position, just one out here. Guzzi's had two ground balls to the left side of the infield. He sends this one into the air, and it's going to drop in and tie the ball game. Rounding third and coming home is Aldrum Corridor. No play at the plate, and the Fightin' Phils are on top, 4-3. Guzzi just lifts that up right over the shortstop and drops it in left center to score two runs. And now this ball game has turned in the favor of the Fightin' Phils. They lead 4-3. Never say die here, this Fightin's team. All over the Rumble Ponies this week. And now the manager, Reed Brignac, is coming in. We'll see if he takes the ball away from his starter, Vargas. He does. So we're going to take a quick break. But we'll be right back. Stuck in the top of the seventh in a very good way. Your Fightin's lead 4-3.
The Enersys Power Alley Pub features a 2.5-hour all-you-can-eat buffet, private bar with bartender, two rows of seats, bar stool seating, and four cafe tables. The pub provides your party a private area to enjoy the ballgame away from other fans. The Enersys Power Alley Pub may accommodate groups of 40 to 60 people. Enjoy socializing with your group and watch the game with a unique vantage point.
Highline Merchandising, formerly Textiles, is your local small business company that provides screen printing, design, and merchandising services for local, national, and international businesses, bands, shows, and festivals, including 7-time Emmy Award-winning show Schitt's Creek and Unsolved Mysteries. Visit our website at highlinemerchandising.com.
Celebrate the history of our national pastime at the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum in Cooperstown. See priceless treasures that will bring your baseball memories to life. Connect with events that have shaped and changed the game and our country. Our stories to tell, your memories to share. Plan your family visit today at baseballhall.org. See you in Cooperstown, where the journey becomes legend.
Seventh, the IR Phils are pounding Binghamton here. They lead 4-3 as Jonathan Guzman singled home both Ortiz and Corridor to tie it and then take a one-run lead. One out here, and Chris Sharp up at the plate. A pitching change for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies as in comes Andrew Mitchell. The final line on Vargas not closed. He's responsible for Guzzi down at first as Chris Sharp takes a swinging strike. He's 1-for-2 today, scored the IR Phils' first run of the game. Lefty here is Mitchell. Runner going. Outside Alvarez from the knees. He bounces it and sliding in safely is Jonathan Guzman. His fifth stolen base of the season breaks up the double play and puts another runner in scoring position here for the Fightin' Phils. It wasn't necessarily a bad throw by Alvarez. Guzzi just got a good hop on it, which is impressive to do with a lefty, but I think taking off really early on and when he's not quite settled. Sharp pops this foul. The inning started off with Ortiz singling. Everybody moved over as Aldrin Corridor reached on a fielder's choice and error allowed them to get on second and third. So a couple of unearned runs there to Vargas. Here's a 1-2 upstairs, 2-2. Guzman singled in two runs, to make it 4-3. Reading has 5 hits. Binghamton just 6, and they have made that costly error in the field. Sharp very far back in the first base batter's box with one out on the board. Here's the 2-2. Drives it to the first base side. Unassisted is Vasquez making the play. Guzman does get 90 feet from home as he shifts to third. Now there's 2 outs on the board here for Kevin Vicuña. Vicuña did have a solo shot into left field. His first of the summer. Top of the 7th here at Mirabito Stadium. Vicuña lifts this sky high. I don't think this one is deep enough as Cortez puts his glove up in the air and makes the catch. But the Fightin' Phils do damage. Jonathan Guzman brings home 2 runs and your R Phils lead 4-3. Bottom of the 7th coming up, but first stretch time here at Mirabito Stadium.
Gear up for Fightin' Phils season. Visit the Brentwood Industries Fightin' Phils team store at First Energy Stadium or check out our online store 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at rphils.com/shop. We have a wide variety of Fightin' Phils hats, t-shirts, kids apparel, and more. Looking for something new? Check out our latest selections of Los Luchadores de Reading and Reading Hot Dogs gear, plus throwback black R-Train R-Phils attire. Root for your Fightins in style. Stop by the Brentwood Industries Fightins team store or rphils.com/shop.
The sound of an ice-cold Corona is music to my ears. Oh, run that back. Dope. Now drop that beat. And hit me with the hook, player. Hey, whatever you do with your fine life, just do you, player. Relax responsibly. Corona Extra Beer, imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois.
The Fightin' Phils know who to call for trash and recycling services. A proven winner, J.P. Mascaro & Sons. The industry leader for over 50 years. Trust the familiar Mascaro Blue Elephant to provide dependable, quality service for your home or business. That's J.P. Mascaro & Sons, one of the top companies in its industry. Trash and recycling services for home, business, and industry. We are hiring and have open positions in Berks County. Check our website for open positions at jpmascaro.com or call 1-888-MASCARO. J.P. Mascaro & Sons, ready to serve you.
Just realized my mic wasn't on for any of that, so that's fun. A first pitch walk to Brandon McIlwain, then Alvarez is caught chasing that amazing slider by Francisco Morales, who came in for Colton Eastman here to start off the bottom of the seventh. Brett Beatty comes up and takes a hack, fouling one back. He had a two-run shot in his last at-bat. Morales coming in for Eastman here in the bottom of the seventh. Your R-Phils lead 4-3. Eastman's final line, 6 innings of work, 6 hits, 3 runs, 4 walks, and 3 strikeouts on 87 pitches. That is a quality start. A quality start is 6 innings or more with 3 runs or left, as I think Beatty fouled that off his foot. He's taking a visit from the trainer, Vanessa Weisbach, right now. McIlwain started off with a walk, so he's down on first with just one out. Looks like Beatty is going to stay in this game as he walks back to the plate. Phillies don't start for another hour and 15 minutes. Lehigh Valley is leading 6-3. They're only in the fourth. Jersey Shore trailing by 2 to the Brooklyn Cyclones. They are in Coney Island right now, bottom of the sixth. And Clearwater is through 5. They're leading 2-1 over Tampa. And, of course, in our game, we're leading 4-3 thanks to Jonathan Guzman's two-run double. This bounces in front of Jack Conley. A wild pitch allows McIlwain to move over to second. And now there's a runner in scoring position with just one out here. Beatty's count 1-1. Mo trying to keep this game for the Fightin' Phils. They're only leading by just one run here as the sun begins to set down the left field line. The wind has died down. That flag out and left is just dead hanging at the pole. Righty-lefty gets him to check his swing, and he does go around strike 2. And now the visiting team isn't happy with the umpire crew. Everybody booing. Joe Young Kim, who pointed to Tom Fornarola, the third base ump for a lefty batter. That's where you point. A ball and 2 strikes, 1 out. Mo takes a deep breath, looks back at second. And now we'll come home outside 2-2. Fans, thanks so much for tuning in. The R-Phils leading this series 2-0. Tomorrow night is going to be a 7 p.m. contest, so it's going to be about 25 minutes later than these past few starts. I think that's because they have post-game fireworks as the 2-2 is sent foul into the stands. Keep his count. Saturday back to 6:35, and Sunday is 1:05 here at Mirabito Stadium as we wrap up the first half. Runner on second, 1 out. Morales in his first inning relief. Here's the 2-2, and he gets him to chase down and away. Jack Conley's going to have to throw it to first, and he does. They're going to try to get the runner at third, taking off is Brandon McIlwain. Got some heads-up base running as he gets his way to third. Just his fifth game in AA. Very insightful player. But there's 2 outs on the board, so a sac fly won't do it from Ronnie Mauricio. Back-to-back strikeouts from Francisco Morales puts 2 outs on the board. And here is Mauricio, who is 1-for-3 today. Had a double, but was stranded back in the fifth. R-Phils lead 4 runs on 5 hits. Binghamton 3 runs on 6 hits. They had a costly error in the last frame. Lefty bat, real shiftier for Mauricio. Guzman is behind second, and Vicuña's very deep at second, like actual where the second baseman would stand, and Guzzi's back behind the bag up the middle. I'll say up the middle from now on. But that's what the numbers say. So that's where you're going to play as he takes a strike. Mauricio from the left side, bat on his shoulder. Here's the 1-1. Chopped up the first baseline. Foul, 1-2. If anybody likes to chase a pitch outside, it's Ronnie Mauricio. There's a Let's Go Ponies chant going on with the charge music being played. So not exactly in line there are these fans. Reading leads 4-3. 2 outs on the board. Mauricio sends it foul. He'll get to go again. Now they play the Let's Go Ponies music. The cloud is clapping. Okay, they're getting it. Runner on third, that's Brandon McElwain. Ball and two strikes here to Ronnie Mauricio. Morales pumps his left foot. Glove at the waist. Here's the 1-2. Bounces over the plate. Conley can't find it. And the tying run scores on a wild pitch. And that all credit is there to McElwain. Because he walked. He moved over on a wild pitch. Moved over again on that strikeout and came home on the wild pitch to tie it up. And you've got to give him the credit there because he made that run happen. So now we're tied up at four apiece, still two outs. A 2-2 count here to Mauricio, and he lines this into right field, but there to make the play is Ortiz, and that will do it. But McElwain crosses the plate, making it 4-4. And into the top of the eighth we go here at Mirabito Stadium. The R fills at the top of their order.
K-Pool and Spa offers a variety of expert services for both in and above ground pools and hot tubs. They provide the service for Pool Pavilion at the First Energy Stadium and keep it clean and maintained throughout the entire season. Based in Reading, Pennsylvania, they've been family owned and operated for 40 years. Turn to K-Pool and Spa for the best value and professional service.
International Fireworks is the official fireworks provider for the R-Fills. International Fireworks shoots all 33 fireworks shows throughout the R-Fills season, including 6 Mega Blast fireworks shows. International Fireworks also provides the pregame fireworks after the national anthem at each game. International Fireworks has a retail store in nearby Douglasville, Pennsylvania, where you can purchase all of your fireworks. Visit fireworksrus.com for more information about the International Fireworks retail store in Douglasville. Thanks again to International Fireworks, the official fireworks provider of the R-Fills.
Looking for the place to have the ultimate family fun at the Fightin' Fills game? Look no further than Capital Blue Cross Funland. Capital Blue Cross Funland features the most exciting games and entertainment at the ballpark, including speed pitch, mini golf, ring toss and peach basket toss, mascot autograph booth, a bounce house, and the incredible giant inflatable slide. Bring your family to all the fun at their next R-Fills game at Capital Blue Cross Funland.
Top of the eighth, we're all knotted up at 4 runs apiece here. A wild pitch by Francisco Morales allowed Brandon McElwain to score in the bottom of the seventh. And Andrew Mitchell out for another inning of work. He'll see Freesia, Castillo, and Akami. The R-Fills are at the top of the order. Freesia takes a first pitch strike. The lefty gets him to foul it into the stands, and he's down 0-2. Vito 1-for-3 today. Continuing that very nice on-base streak to 16 games so far this season, dating back to June 4th. He's had 17 hits, 13 walks, and one hit by pitch that allowed him to reach as he takes a ball up and away, 1-2. The longest on-base streak of the summer for him was 16 before this. He did that from April 27th through May 21st. So now tying that as he sends this foul into the dugout, almost hitting coach Tyler Henson over there. Keeps his 1-2 count. And the longest of the season belongs to Logan Ohapi with 21. He did that May 14th to June 8th. Mitchell deals another foul ball back. And he'll keep his 1-2 count. Andrew came in and helped his teammate get out of the seventh with allowing any more runs to cross. Now he's in his own clean inning as Freesia snags another one up high for a foul ball back. Pitch number 7 impending. Time is called. Vito's granted it. He steps out of the bag. Reading 5 hits, Binghamton 6. They've made a crucial error in the field. Both teams 4 runs. Here's the 1-2 Vito holds off as it's down and away. Boos again from the crowds here. And Vito steps back in. A wide stance. 2 balls, 2 strikes. And he goes down swinging here. Some high heat from Andrew Mitchell. I tell you how high, but the radar gun doesn't work here in Binghamton. So there's out number 1 for Ollie Castillo. Castillo 0-3, looks for a bunt, takes strike number 1. Certainly the kind of guy that could run out a bunt. 4 base hit. Wide open stance here, his left foot much further from the plate than his right foot. Keeps the bat on his shoulder and takes a ball above the letters. Josh Ockamy waiting in the on-deck circle. And there's a ball down and away. One out here, top of the 8th inning in the back part of this ball game. And Ali sends this sky high up the elevator shaft down the third baseline. Brett Beatty makes the catch in fair territory in front of the Fightin' Phil's dugout for out number 2. And here is Josh Ockamy. And Ockamy is due up for it. He is 0-3, 3 times caught looking up at the plate. He takes a first pitch ball. Infield, outfield, back deep. Bakami sends this foul into the net behind home plate. Way inside. Josh has to bounce back to avoid being hit by the pitch. And it's 2-1 here. Lefty-lefty matchup. It's his first time seeing Andrew Mitchell here. 2 outs, top of the 8th, knotted up at 4. Josh shakes a ball down and away and leads the count 3-1. Jalen Ortiz in the elusive on-deck circle. Here's the 3-1. Josh chases an off-speed pitch, and now the count is full. Lefties settle in. Alvarez on the outside part of the plate, and there is ball 4. Ockamy takes a walk with 2 outs, putting the go-ahead run on first here for Jalen Ortiz. Crowd not happy with the call by Jo Young Kim. I mean, I don't think anybody will be. But here is Jalen Ortiz from the right side with a runner on and 2 away. He's 1-3 in the contest in his last at-bat, singled. Just looking to keep the line moving. Takes a first pitch swinging strike way behind the ball. Ortiz, another swinging strike down 0-2. Runner on first, 2 away. Ortiz takes a ball up above the letters. The count moves to 1-2. Manager Sean Williams gives the sign. Josh Ockamy gets some information from Mike Jones. Down at first, he shuffles off the bag. Tie ball game, 4-4, top of the eighth. Reading looking to do something, but Ortiz strikes out swinging, and that is a big out pickup for Mitchell to get out of the frame, stranding a runner on. And on to the bottom half we go. We'll see who comes out to pitch. Looks like Francisco Morales for another inning of work in just a moment.
You can add a delicious all-you-can-eat buffet to any Reading Fightin' Phil's game ticket for only $19. No need to visit the concession stands. You can add a 2.5-hour all-you-can-eat buffet to any ticket. This selection includes barbecue chicken, barbecue sandwiches, cheeseburgers, hamburgers, hot dogs, mac and cheese, corn, pasta salad, baked beans, potato salad, chips, fruit, cookies, and all Pepsi products. Call the Fightins at 610-370-BALL, order online at fightins.com, or visit the Wide and Hammer ticket office at First Energy Stadium.
Unlike any other area in First Energy Stadium, the Savage 61 dugout suite puts you in the closest seat to the action on field, located just feet away from the diamond on the first base side. With covered seating, abilities in motion accessible seating, and the most unique view around, your group will thank you over and over again for this one-of-a-kind experience. Tickets for the dugout suite start at $25 and include options to add food and drink packages.
The Reading Fightin' Phils are proud to partner with Mau Beer and Stockertown Beverage throughout the 2022 season. Mau Beer and Mau's Cinco Estrellas Lager, which is available in the Stadium Plaza Bar, has 128 amazing years of brewing history. Make sure to pick up Mau Beer and Mau's Cinco Estrellas Lager at First Energy Stadium at our Plaza Bar throughout the 2022 season and through our partner at Stockertown Beverage. Mau Beer will be on site for all of our Fiesta Friday games with samplings of their amazing Cinco Estrellas Lager. Mau Beer is a proud partner of the Reading Fightin' Phils and all Fiesta Friday celebration games. Mau Beer, the five-star taste and quintessential beer from Madrid. Please drink responsibly.
Francisco Morales out for another inning of work. He'll see Carlos Cortez, Hayden Sanger, and Jeremy Vasquez. He allowed a run in the seventh, sort of. He walked a batter, and then on a couple of wild pitches, basically McElwain was able to come home and score. Obviously, he's responsible for it. But I think a lot of credit is deserved to McElwain for the way that he ran the bases. Probably not a lot of other players would, A, have the foresight or B, the capability to do that. Cortez takes the first pitch strike. There's one in the dirt that makes the count 1-1. Both teams, 4 runs apiece. The R-Phils, 5 hits. Binghamton, 6. They had a costly error in the field. We're in the bottom of the eighth inning here at Mirabito Stadium. The sun continues to set beyond the left field fence. I mean, it's still light out. The lights are on at the ballpark, illuminating everything. But what a beautiful night here. Righty-lefty matchup, the 1-1 from Mo. Up and away, 2-1. 23 pitches coming into this frame. Takes a deep breath. And a swinging strike out of Cortez evens the count. He's 1-for-2 today, an RBI single in the third, a walk in the second. Both teams using just 2 pitchers so far in this contest. The starters went deep on either side. This is a ground ball. Down to first, it rolls foul just in front of the bag. Ockamy gives a good chase, but not necessary. And the count stays 2-2. Cortez takes his time, stepping back in the batter's box. Morales comes set, glove at the chest, pumps his left leg as he brings his glove down. 2 balls, 2 strikes. And he checks his swing and he goes around. And now he's going to have to run down to first. Conley pumps it. He wasn't running. And that was bad on Carlos Cortez. He certainly could have got to first as the pitch was wild. As he took strike 3, not happy with the call from the umpire. I think maybe he's saying he connected with it. And now Reed Brignac is going to come talk to the umpire here. So what happened is it was a strike three swinging wild pitch that got away from Jack. It went all the way to the backstop. And I guess Cortez thought he made contact because he never really ran down to first. And then everybody started yelling and he started jogging, not really running. And it gave Jack plenty of time to throw all the way from the backstop. So works out. It's out number one here. Hayden Sanger up 0 for 3 today from the right side. Takes a first pitch strike on the outside corner. There's a ball down and away. Bottom of the eighth inning here at Mirabito Stadium. Binghamton is the home team, so they will get to bat last as we are still tied in this ball game. We'll see how things shake out here in the last inning and a half as Morales pitches above the letters 2-1. That drops into the strike zone 2-2. I wish I could see how fast Mo is throwing here. No radar gun at the ballpark. Time is called. Sanger is granted it. Out of the batter's box he goes. Now he'll step back in on the right side. One out on the board. Mo working the bottom of the eighth. Here's the 2-2. Cuts on and misses. Did he go around? No. Says Matt Carleone out on first, and he'll get another chance. He'll get another chance. Our Phils played home next week. Looking forward to having a blast on Independence Day weekend. I mean, we're home all week, Tuesday through Sunday, but July 1st, 2nd, and 3rd is going to be a lot of fun. Here's the payoff pitch, and he blazes a fastball right by Singer, way late to it, and he comes up with a strikeout, back-to-back Ks for Mo here. Puts two outs on the board, and Jeremy Vasquez two up. The first baseman, number 20, Jeremy Vasquez. On the left side, Vasquez takes a first pitch ball. He's 1-for-3 today. A lot of balls in the air coming out of the next three batters. Mo misses back-to-back pitches, 2-0. Looking to set down the side in order to put his team up in the top of the ninth. They'll have three outs left in regular play. And Mo misses 3-0. Infield, outfield, back deep, two outs on the board. Bottom of the eighth, the 3-1 misses down and away, and there is ball four. The go-ahead run down on first, and Jeremy Vasquez and Manny Rodriguez up with two outs. Rodriguez 0-for-3, but he hasn't seen Morales yet. And now manager Sean Williams is going to come out to talk to Morales here. Sean does this when it's late and close, and he has something very specific he wants to say to his infield. It's very quick always. It's probably 10 seconds or less. He comes out, he gives his message, whether it be, you know, I don't know what it is, so I'm not going to even guess. But he comes out quickly, and he says it. Sean probably one of the only managers to come out during the game not to switch pitchers. It has to be the manager that changes the pitchers. But Sean will come out and give these words when needed. And we're in the bottom of the eighth. We're tied up at four. This game is late and close. Mo has the go-ahead run on first, but he's got two outs. And he sends a first pitch strike to Manny Rodriguez on the outside corner. Manny's 0-for-3, a strikeout and two balls in the air. Runner on first is Jeremy Vasquez. Here's the 0-1. Now it's 0-2. A hefty swing by Rodriguez almost bounces his helmet off. Gets the sign from his catcher, Jack Conley, sets up on the outside corner. Down and up, here's the 0-2, and a wild swing and a miss. He strikes out the side, stranding the go-ahead runner on first. And on to the ninth we go, tied up at 4.
The Reading Fightin' Phils are pleased to present you with their classic game program, all electronically. This program has information on the coaching staff, player roster, and front office staff. It also includes feature stories and alumni reports on all of your favorite guys who spend time in baseball town. Visit rphils.com/programs to check it out.
Our Phils fans can continue to expect great performances all season long on the Berks Commercial Roofing Stage. It's the home of great local talent, including the Our Phils mascot band. Berks Commercial Roofing prides itself on being a locally owned and operated company that puts an emphasis on customer service. They provide free on-site estimates and can handle any size repair, restoration, or replacement. Visit BerksCommercialRoofing.com or call 610-717-3949 for more information. And don't forget to sit back, relax, and enjoy the show at the Berks Commercial Roofing Stage at America's Classic Ballpark.
At Savage 61, our goal is to assist you in making a confident decision. Our friendly professional staff members are available to answer your questions and listen to your needs. Whether you're shopping for a new or pre-owned vehicle, we're ready to help you with your search. Visit our dealership on Pottsville Pike.
Mo struck out the side to get us out of the bottom of the eighth, so we're all tied up at 4 apiece. On to the ninth, the Rumble Ponies will bat last, so they'll have the bottom half. Each team 3 outs to go here in regular baseball. And hopefully the Fightin' Phils can finish it now as they see a new pitcher on the mound. Antonio Santos will take over for Andrew Mitchell, who shut down the Fightin's 1 2/3 innings of work. No hits, no runs, 1 walk, 2 strikeout, 28 pitches. And now a righty Santos here against the lefty Corridor, who takes the first pitch, ball outside. Anybody that comes up represents the go-ahead run here. Aldrum scored back in the 7th, reached on a fielder's choice. A big leg kick from Santos. He pumps this back into the net behind home plate. And it's strike number 1, 6-3-2-23. That is a big man up on the mound. I mean, but Aldrum is too. Certainly got a lot of power in him. 1-1, lefty takes above his letters. 2-1. Santos was claimed off of waivers in 2021. Comes on the inside corner to Aldrum. He's already had his major league debut. He did that in the pandemic season in 2020. And a little bit in 2021, just 10 appearances. The lefty pokes this down the left field line, and it just ropes foul. Count stays 2-2. He's had 17 1/3 innings of professional experience, both with the Colorado Rockies. Then after the 2021 season, he was claimed by the Mets off of waivers. Originally signed by Colorado back on July 2nd, 2015. The 2-2 way in, bumping Corridor back, and now the count is full. Reading just trying to put a runner on. So Eastern League experience with the Hartford Yard Goats and now here with the Binghamton Rumble Ponies. Righty's 25 years old. And on the payoff pitch, Corridor Chase is down and away for strike three. And there is out number one to start off the ninth. Anybody can get the job done here as Jack Conley comes up 0-for-3 today. He didn't play in the last two games, and it's tough to keep that swing if you're not getting everyday playing time. But Jack certainly has the power and the wherewithal to swing at solid pitches here as he takes a ball in the dirt. He's had a pretty good season, to be honest with you. Played a lot in the outfield, had some couple of really good at-bats. Takes a called strike, one and one here. Swings on a pitch, taking him down to his knees, one and two. We'll have to see who comes in for the bottom of the ninth. Obviously, Redding looking to take the lead here. Maybe Marconi pitched on Tuesday. Here's the 1-2. Jack takes a pitch in the dirt. Evens at 2-2. A lot of guys available in the bullpen as well. A couple of different moves available for Sean Williams depending on how we end this inning. Here's the 2-2. Jack gets a piece of it to foul it back in the net behind home plate. Redding 4 runs on 5 hits. Binghamton 4 runs on 6 hits. They've made an error in the field. We're in the top of the ninth. We're tied up. Redding has one out, and Jack Conley's up at the plate with a 2-2 count. Here's the pitch from Santos inside, and the count is full. Waiting on deck, Jonathan Guzman. Here's the payoff pitch. Jack pops it up down the first baseline, coming over as Vasquez by the dugout. It's going to end up on the top part out of the field of play, and Jack's going to get another chance. This is back-to-back full count here for Santos. Taking a minute to allow the defensive players to get back into their positions. A lot of people came over for that foul ball. Three balls, two strikes, one out on the board. Santos kicks and fires the payoff pitch to Jack, and he drives this into right center. It's going to drop in for a base hit. He works the at-bat and comes out on top. Pitch number 8. Ends up with a base hit for Jack Conley, and Redding has the go-ahead runner on first here with one out. It's Jonathan Guzman. Guzzi already had the big hit in this contest. Single that scored 2 runs back in the 7th. Santos comes upstairs to Jonathan Guzman, ball number 1. Both teams now 4 runs and 6 hits. Jack Conley out on first. He's had 1 stolen base this season. I doubt he'll risk it, but if it gets by Alvarez, oh, he's going. He's off. A swinging strike, and he slides right in, and the ball pops out of the glove. Jack Conley safe at second. Guzzi took a high swinging strike. And he gets himself to scoring position, and he breaks up the double play. You'll love to see it. Rodriguez just couldn't keep the ball in his glove. It was a good throw by Alvarez. And Jack now on second. Here's the 1-1. Guzzi takes outside. 2-1. Jack. 2 stolen bases on the season. That's a career high for him. He's had 1 every year of his professional career. But he said he worked on his speed in the offseason. Jonathan takes a called strike down and away. And it's 2-2 now. Just trying to get this winning run home. We're all tied up at 4 apiece. The crowd was invested. I'm invested. You're invested. top of the ninth here in Binghamton. Conley shuffles off at second. One out, the 2-2, and Guzzi takes the pitch down and away. Strikes out, swinging, chasing, and now there's two outs. And here is Chris Sharp. He's 1-for-3 today, singled and scored Redding's first run of the game in the third. Puts the bat on his shoulder. Conley out on second, two outs. Santos gives him a look. He comes home way outside. Really good block by Alvarez. Calls time, gets a fresh baseball. Glove at the chest for Santos. The 1-0, Sharp sends foul on the roof, 1-1. Santos, a 4.76 ERA here with the Rumble Ponies. Spent time in AAA Syracuse as well as Chris Sharp takes the ball below the knees. Here's the 2-1. Sharp takes. That's a called strike on the outside corner. And now it's even 2-2. Grabbing the rosin bag is Santos. Redding's got that go-ahead runner and Jack Conley out on second. And Chris Sharp up at the plate with a 2-2 count. Ooh, it's tight. It's fun. This is what it's made of. Santos looks back. Here's a 2-2 to Chris, and he strikes out swinging. Antonio Santos pumps his chest as Redding leaves the go-ahead run on second base. To the bottom of the ninth we go, tied at 4. And now I'm hoping we see extras. We'll be right back in just a minute. Don't go anywhere, Fightins fans. Bottom of the ninth inning, we're all tied up at 4, and it's on the shoulders of Brian Marconi to try to get the Fightin' Phils out of this frame scoreless. And I don't say this often, but hoping for a 10th inning here, because that would mean the Fightin' Phils are still in this game as Binghamton trying to walk it off in the bottom of the ninth. Decent crowd here at the ballpark, and those that are here are certainly very invested as Brian Marconi will see Matt Winokur and then back to the top of the order with Brandon McElwain and Francisco Alvarez. Winokur takes a first pitch strike on the outside corner. We saw Marconi on Tuesday, got his ninth save of the season, a clean, slamming the door shut. As Winokur fouls one back, he's down 0-2. Marconi then faced Alvarez, Beatty, and Mauricio on Tuesday. Mets 1, 2, and 3 prospects, and he shut them all down. So looking to keep that in line here in the bottom of the ninth. This is a blooper up the middle, charging Castillo, bare hand to first. Got him. Ali at the hot corner gets the job done. Are you kidding? What a play. And there's out number one. Not many people would make a play like that over at third, and that kind of puts the energy in you. One out on the board here as we go to the top of the order with Brandon McIlwain. He's had a good day at the plate. Two walks, but that fourth run that he was responsible for in the seventh was everything for his team. First pitch strike, lefty on righty matchup here. Marconi comes outside 1-1. Both teams, 4 runs on 6 hits. Marconi deals on the outside corner, called strike. McIlwain taking a bit to step in. Puts the bat on his shoulder. Marconi unfazed by these situations. Here's the 1-2. Just down and away, too far. Checks his swing. Does he go around? No. Full count. Redding started the scoring. One on in the third. Vito Frisia batted home Chris Sharp. A solo shot by Vicuña in the sixth. And then 2 runs came off the bat of Jonathan Guzman. That's how they got their 4. This is ripped down the third baseline. Ali dives for it, but it's going to go all the way to the wall. McIlwain is going to hold up at second. Good relay in by Vito Frisia, and they get the go-ahead run on second base. Binghamton scored their first run in the third. Carlos Cortez batted home Francisco Alvarez. A 2-run home run by Brett Beatty. And then in the seventh, Brandon McIlwain came home on a wild pitch. Now they're threatening here in the ninth. Brian Marconi will see Alvarez and Brett Beatty. And they're going to intentionally walk Alvarez here. And I think that's because they want the lefty-lefty matchup and also because it'll set them up for the double play. I don't know if it says more about facing Alvarez versus Beatty. Beatty's had a home run in this contest. I think it's more about the lefty-lefty matchup and the ground ball opportunity here. And now it's a force, too. Now it forces McIlwain to move instead of holding up a second. Lefty Marconi to lefty Beatty. He's on the first base side of the rubber. Big leg quick. He comes inside. Connolly's going to have to be perfect back behind the plate. Ronnie Mauricio in the on-deck circle for Binghamton. Brian looks back at second. 1-0 outside, checks his swing. 2-0. Intense contest here. Redding leads the series 2-0. Glove at the waist. Gets past Jack Conley, picks it up, fires to third, the tag. Safe, but it was a perfect throw by Jack. Right on the dirt, right in front of the bag at third, but both runners advance here. Two in scoring position now, and that intentional walk doesn't work out yet for the Fightin Phils. And Brett Beatty up at the plate with a 3-0 count. Infield's going to come in. They're going to try to get the out at home here. One out on the board, bottom of the ninth. 4-4 the score. Marconi deals inside, and that's ball four. And now the infield's going to go back, I think, because that does set up the double play ball in the forced play again. Bases loaded, bottom nine. Brian Marconi's going to see a visit from Sean Williams as Ronnie Mauricio comes up. He's a hot and cold kind of guy. 0-4 yesterday. Struck out all four times. Today he had a double. He's going to chase. And Sean knows that. No damage done as of yet. The bases are loaded. There's one out, so everybody's forced to move, and a ball on the ground could turn too. Sean breaks up the meeting on the mound. He's ready to rock and roll here. Conley heads back behind the plate. The infielders get their cues, and we'll see where they're going to stand. They're going to play in. So that probably means they're forfeiting the double play here for the out at home, if that's what it comes to. Mauricio takes the ball outside. McElwain, Alvarez, Beatty around the infield, third to first, respectively. Mauricio at the plate. Swing and a miss in the dirt. 1-1. Everybody in the bullpen for the R Phils is standing up on that hill. They do not have a good vantage point here. Crowd is up here at Mirabito Stadium. The 1-1. Ronnie Mauricio pops this up. It's foul, and it's strike two as it hits the roof and comes back down. It ain't over yet. One ball, two strikes, one out on the board. Lefty Marconi kicks and fires, and Mauricio strikes out swinging. Conley gets the tag on him, and there's out number two. Huge pickup there by Marconi to stay locked in. And here is Carlos Cortez. He's got a hit in today's contest, also a walk. And he will come in on the left side to the lefty Marconi with the bases loaded. A chance to walk it off for his team, but not if Brian has anything to say about it. Trying to put the team up into the 10th. But he's got to get out of the ninth here. Deals, ground ball right side. 4-3, they get out of the frame. A huge moment for the Fightin Phils with the bases loaded and one out. Brian Marconi keeps this game tied. We're going to 10. Fans, stick around. The opportunity continues for the Fightin Phils. What an inning by Brian Marconi.
The Seidel Auto Group Deck Picnic appeals to both diehard and casual fans with its summer picnic-like and fun tailgate atmosphere. During your picnic, you may even catch a souvenir, as the area is situated directly in prime home run territory behind the left field wall. Regular season tickets are $30 per person for groups of 20 or more, and children 4 and under are free. Visit fightins.com/groups or call 610-370-BALL to reserve your group outing today.
Golden Oaks is an award-winning, high-end golf club that offers golfers a country club experience without country club prices. With five sets of tees, golfers of every skill level will enjoy their game. Golden Oaks has Bogey's Pub, a beautiful pro shop, driving range, and learning center that will make any visit complete. Golden Oaks Golf Club is the perfect venue for private events and golf outings. Visit us for our newly opened golf simulators, complete with its own bar area and Bogey's Pub menu items available.
You can stay in our beautifully restored 1850s farmhouse and then play our award-winning championship golf course. Each room includes full amenities, cable television, and quaint rustic decor. While on the premises, visit Bogey's Pub for lunch, dinner, or a relaxing beverage. We're ready to serve you here at Golden Oaks and look forward to the 2022 season.
On to the 10th we go, tied at 4 here at Mirabito Stadium. Antonio Sanchez stays on the mound. Chris Sharp was the final out of the 9th, so he's going to be that inherited runner for Santos. He gets to start out on 2nd. And Kevin Vicuña will lead us off the bottom of the order before we go to Vito Freixa and Ollie Castillo. Kevin's got that solo home run here already under his belt today as he takes a first pitch above the letters. Santos had a hit allowed in the 9th, but struck out the side. It did take him quite a number of pitches, 25, so we'll see how long he lasts. Vicuña is going to get the runner over, and he's excited about that. That's what you try to do. He moves Chris Sharp 90 feet from home here, even though he grounds out. There's one out on the board, but he used his out very importantly, and now the infield's going to come in here for Vito Freixa, and all he's trying to do is smack a ball deep enough that will allow Sharp to score. Now, Chris has pretty good speed on him. He's the kind of guy that could definitely come home if Alvarez passes something. As Vito takes a ball below the knees, he's 1-for-4 today. Of course, when Binghamton comes up in the bottom half, they'll have that inherited runner on as well. Hoping we see Brian Marconi for another frame, but you never know. Infield playing in the 1-0 to Vito Freixa is popped foul. 1-1, I think he wanted that pitch. Sharp started at 2nd, came over to 3rd on Kevin Vicuña's round ball. And Vito Freixa with a wide stance and one out on the board takes the 1-1 here from Santos inside. And the count moves to 2-1. Our Phils, 4 runs on 6 hits. Binghamton, 4 runs on 7 hits. They made one defensive miscue in the field tonight. Here's the 2-1 to Vito Freixa. It's in the dirt. I'm laughing because Alvarez literally laid on top of it to stop it from rolling somewhere. Really used, let's talk about using your body, I guess. And it's 3-1 here to Vito Freixa. Santos kicks and fires, and he chases for strike 2. Infield playing a step in on that grass. No wind right now. Baseball under the lights. A beautiful Thursday in upstate New York. Here's the payoff pitch. Freixa takes what he thinks is ball 4, and he's rung up by Joe Young Kim. An aggressive strike call as Freixa picks up his bat and heads back to the dugout. There is out number 2. And Ollie Castillo has to do better than a sack fly now. Redding's got a runner 90 feet from home. They cannot let this go. They just cannot. Castillo takes the called strike at the knees. Sharp takes a couple steps off the bag over on 3rd. Castillo sends this foul, and he's down 0-2 in the count, waiting on deck Josh Ockamy. Here's the 0-2 with two outs. Ball way down and away. Alvarez once again on his stomach trying to protect the plate. Two outs, tied at four, runner on third. The 0-2, Castillo drives this up the middle, and it's caught. And Redding passes by the top of the 10th without plating a run, stranding runner on third. And into the bottom half we go. Marconi's going to have to work here to hold Binghamton scoreless in just a moment. Brian Marconi will get the bottom of the 10th. The R-Fills had Chris Sharp on third, but they couldn't bring him home. And so now we're still tied at four, bottom of the 10th. Marconi will see Hayden Sanger, Jeremy Vasquez, and Manny Rodriguez. Carlos Cortez will start out on second. That's the inherited placed runner. And Akami's sinking a bunt here from Sanger, just trying to move the runner over. He's playing up and in at first. Castillo's up, but not as much as the ball comes inside. Count is 1-0. Marconi got in a jam in the ninth, but was able to get out of it without allowing any runs to score. But he will have to work around a runner on second here. Lefty sends this one above the letters, 2-0. Sanger 0-for-4 today. Marconi gets him to pop foul 2-1. Brian, 22 pitches here. Trying to just keep his team in this game. Now I'm hoping for an 11th. Graze is on the outside part of the plate, but it's a ball, 3-1. Runner on second, nobody out. Brian deals inside, good block by Jack. It's ball four. That allows Sanger to move over to first. There are two runners on. And nobody out here for Jeremy Vasquez. It does give an opportunity for a double play ball here. Just have to keep their eye on the runner at third. Jeremy Vasquez is 1-for-3 with a walk as well. This is a good spot in the order to be in if you're Redding, because not much has happened in these bottom four batters. There's a ball inside. Two on, nobody out. Marconi dealing to a lefty here. Bunt laid down. Castillo's going to pick it up. They're going to try to turn two. They just get a runner at second, and now there's runners on the corners. One out. Binghamton does get a runner 30 or 90 feet from home. 30 feet, that'd be kind of insane. So Vasquez safe at first on a fielder's choice. Sanger was out at second. And over at third is Carlos Cortez. Runners on the corners, one out for Manny Rodriguez. And now Sean is going to come in again, trying to draw up a play. A ground ball could get a double play. But a sac fly, any run that scores is the game-winning run here. We're tied up at four. We're in the bottom of the 10th. Sean's coming back out. The team knows what they got to do. Rodriguez is a righty. Winokur is a lefty. Manager Reed Brignac is giving the signs to his team. Rodriguez 0 for 4 today. Two strikeouts, two balls in the air. Carlos Cortez over at third here with one out on the board. Marconi leans over. He gets the sign from Jack Conley. Infield's going to come in. First pitch hits the outside corner, strike one. It's Rodriguez and Winokur rounding out 8 and 9 before they go back to the top of the order. Signs of bunt by Rodriguez, but he takes a ball. Cortez on third, Vasquez on first. One out here, tie ball game, bottom of the 10th. Brian Marconi, glove at the waist, comes outside, 2-1. Game number 3 of the 6-game set. We're here in Binghamton through Sunday. Runner going. Swing and a miss by Rodriguez. Conley lets him take. That does mess up the double play there by the Fightin Phils, but couldn't risk having Cortez comes home. And the count evens 2-2. Two, a called strike three. Rung up is Manny Rodriguez looking, and that changes this. Two outs on the board, two runners in scoring position, and it's all on the shoulders of Matt Winokur here. Not if Ryan Marconi has anything to say about it for the second inning in a row, trying to keep his team tied up in this ballgame. A sac fly will not cut it anymore. Swing and a miss, strike one. Conley's going to have to be perfect back there. Anything by him, Cortez at third is coming. When Redding comes up in the top of the 11th, that's when I said when they come up. Akemi Ortiz and Corridor are due up. Here's the 0-1. Popped up foul, 0-2. Two outs, tie ball game, bottom of the 10th inning. Two runners on. And here is the 0-2 from Brian Marconi to Winokur. It's upstairs. And it's ball one. Crazy, crazy. This is a great game. Battling here is Brian Marconi. He is locked in. Gets the sign from Jack Conley. Glove at the waist. Cortez out on third. Vasquez on second. Here's the 1-2. Fouled back. Winokur stays alive. Winokur batting just 131 right now, 0-for-4 in this contest. Brian up to 34 pitches. I think he had an outing with 40-something earlier this summer. Here's the 1-2 inside, and he hits him. And they're going to say that he leaned into that. Sean is going to come argue. Jack Conley is arguing. He certainly did not make any effort to move out of the way. I'll say that. And he was crowding the plate. He was over the plate there as well. And now we're going to have a visit with all the umpires. Vicuña saying he stuck his elbow out. He certainly made no effort to move. And he was over top of the plate. Lefty coming inside to another lefty. All the umpires are deciding. And they're going to give him first. And now Sean is going to continue to talk to Jay and Kim behind the plate, who's shaking his hand at him. And he's talking to Matt Carleone over at first. And now he's getting a little aggressive here. He's yelling at him. He's gone. And he'll fight for his guys. All these coaching staff will fight for their guys. And he is feisty here, and as he should be. His crew has been tough all series long. And he's going to get his money's worth. He's already been ejected. He might as well give it to him. And the bases are loaded here for Brian Marconi with two outs. And he'll see Brandon McIlwain, who's really been doing the damage today. Sean's going to head back into the dugout here. He's actually going to head back into the clubhouse because he's ejected from the contest. And awarded first is Matt Winokur. So bases are loaded here, and Marconi is going to have to work against Brandon McIlwain, who had a double last time up against Marconi, but he's coming with some heat. He is fired up here, and he takes a first pitch strike on the outside corner. It's Cortez, Vasquez, and Winokur left to right across the infield. Two outs on the board. Marconi deals. Foul ball back, 0-2. One strike away about getting us on to the 11th. Marconi leans over, gets the sign from Jack Conley. He's ready to go. Bases loaded, 2-0. Oh, time is called by McIlwain. Come on. We're ready to go. Bases loaded, 2 outs, bottom of the 10th, tied at 4. Marconi, the 0-2 pitch to McIlwain. Up the middle, it's going to be played by Guzzi over to first. The pick is no good. McIlwain walks it off with a base hit up the middle, and they mob him out in center. Binghamton walks it off 5-4 in the bottom of the 10th. Jack's going to give it to the umpires here as he's walking off. His teammates are pushing him out of the way. We've seen post-game ejections before. But, dang. Now they're really arguing. Vicuña's going after the umpires. Henny's coming out. I think he's going to tell Vicuña to go back in. The game is done. And a tough way to go. We see this crew for the next 3 games. And the R-Fills, I think, are just frustrated with how that worked out. Because it wasn't the baseball. And there's a difference there. But Binghamton walks it off in the bottom of the 10th. They win 5-4. But they still lead the series 2-1 as we head into tomorrow night's game. It's a 7:05 start here at Mirabito Stadium. I'll be on the air bringing you all the action. Fans, thanks for joining me. We'll see you tomorrow.